I hereby call the order this meeting of the Sunderland Select Board. The time is 6:15. Before we get started, just a quick little note for anyone who might be listening. We are going to suspend the normal public comment for this meeting. We will not be entertaining it, but that will resume at our next meeting. So our first order of business will be to approve the minutes from our last two meetings, September 16th and September 20th.
I motion we approve the minutes from September 16th and September 20th.
Second.
All right, we have a motion made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Roll call is needed for remote.
For Dan.
Aye, Dan Murphy.
Aye. All right. Aye. 3-0. Thank you. All right, our first order of new business will be to approve a one-day liquor license for Kitchen Garden Farms, LLC.
They're not on today.
Is there any discussion needed for that one?
The Kitchen Garden Farm will be having an event on October 12th from 6 to 10 p.m. The expected attendance is 100 people. They have submitted all of the liquor liability insurance certificates, and they have gotten approval from the police chief regarding a parking plan. So I don't believe we're waiting on anything. However, I would ask that the motion contain that contingency in case anything else is needed.
And is that's a residential neighborhood?
It is a residential neighborhood. They've given the chief the plan as far as parking. The event is going to be held at their farm outdoors on the grass lawn, and the chief has expressed no concern with that.
Great.
All right. I motion we approve the liquor license for Garden Kitchen or Kitchen Garden?
Kitchen Garden.
Kitchen Garden on October 12th.
Second.
All right, we have motion made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, Dan Murphy.
Aye. 3-0. Thank you. All right, our next order of business will be to sign the state election warrant for November 5th's election. I'm assuming you need a motion to approve that. At this time, I would entertain a motion to approve the state election warrant.
Go ahead, Dan.
Motion to approve the state election warrant.
Second.
All right, we have a motion made and seconded to approve the state election warrant. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, Dan Murphy.
Aye, Nathaniel Waring. That's 3-0. All right.
Okay.
That's all of our new business. The other three pieces of new business that we have on the agenda for today all have to do with designating select board members for specific duties.
Well, we do have to do the one for October 8th.
Yes. Before that. So the first two of them, the one for SES and the one for the Capital Planning Committee, we're going to push that off until our next meeting. The third item is designating a select board member for the October 8th meeting with Franklin Tech Teachers Association negotiations.
That is going to be an in-person meeting at 4:30 p.m. in the library conference room at Franklin County Tech School on October 8th, Tuesday.
Is there anybody who would like to do that?
Is there any possibility of them allowing remote access soon?
I have not checked. I can certainly check.
I think me and Dan probably both for a 4:30 meeting, unfortunately. It's a little early in the day, probably even for you, right?
Yeah, I'd have to move things around to make it work.
Okay.
If it was remote, I can do something like that.
Okay. I can't answer that. Sure. I just don't know.
I'll volunteer for that. If I can make it work in person, great. If remote's an option, great. If I can't, it is what it is.
All right. So then can we do a contingent? If he's can't make it work,
he can
get a hold of me and I'll see if I can make it work.
Yeah, that's totally fine. They're just looking for a member of the board. So go ahead.
It's tough. Tough timer.
It is. It's an odd time.
Yeah, but unfortunately, you know.
So Nathaniel, we'll try, and as a contingency, you will try.
Yep.
Perfect. So motion.
All right. At the time, I entertain a motion to appoint myself as the primary delegate to the Franklin Tech Teachers Association negotiations, and Crystal as the backup.
So I motion that Nathaniel be the primary for Franklin Tech, and in the event that he's unable to attend, I will make attempts to attend.
Okay.
Second.
All right. We have a motion made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, Dan Murphy.
3-0. Thank you very much.
Okay.
All right. The other two items we will table until next time. We've got a couple minutes to go before our first candidate comes up.
Go ahead. Yeah. So I'll be introducing our human resources consultant in a moment here as she brings up our the board's first finalist to be interviewed this evening. I just want to give the board a brief summary of the search process that we've followed to date. The town administrator position was advertised the third week of August on the town website, the Massachusetts Municipal Association website, LinkedIn, the UMass and Smith College and Harvard Kennedy School alumni sites, the Mass Higher Career Center, the Master List, which is a list for state and municipal jobs, the Small Town Administrators Listserv, and to connections of the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. So we advertised the position broadly. 13 application packets were received, 12 of them by the September 16th date that was mentioned in the ad and one following that. There were 10 candidates from Massachusetts, 2 candidates from New Hampshire, and 1 that gave no address. 10 of the candidates were men and 3 of the candidates were women. 7 candidates whose resumes best reflected the attributes listed in the ideal candidate profile and challenge statement the board approved were interviewed remotely with HR consultant Deborah Radway, who I'll introduce to the board and the public in a moment, and me the week of September 16th. 4 candidates were designated as finalists and invited to interview with the select board in person this evening. None of the finalists have withdrawn their names from consideration. You will meet all 4. The 4 finalists were each asked to submit a sample spreadsheet and a written memo or presentation that reflects their work. These samples have been received and revised, or reviewed, I'm sorry, for clarity, relevance, and professionalism, and they're available for the board's review. Proof of educational attainment was requested and provided by the candidates and can be made available to the board. Each finalist was also asked to provide the contact information for 3 professional references. They all complied, and Ms. Radway has completed 3 comprehensive reference checks for each of the finalists. A summary of the references can be made available to the board. A CORI, criminal offender record information check, will be done prior to hire on the finalist accepting a conditional offer of employment. Lastly, Deborah Radway is here with me this evening. Deborah and I and the board recognize both the critical importance of the town administrator position and that great competition exists for the town administrator positions in this region and across the Commonwealth. Deb and I are very excited that the 4 finalists you'll talk with tonight see Sunderland as a community they'd like to be part of. Your first candidate tonight is here, and this is Nicholas Cacamo. Nick has extensive experience in municipal government, having previously served as a city councilor in Pittsfield from 2014 to 2021, and as Williamsburg's current town administrator since May of 2021. Prior to this, he was employed in the education field for 6 years. He holds a dual master's degree in public policy and administration and regional planning from UMass Amherst, and a bachelor's degree in secondary education from Champlain College. Welcome, Nick.
Hi, Margaret. Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you.
All right. Thank you very much for being with us today, Nick.
Yeah,
appreciate it very much. Do you prefer Nick or Nicholas?
Nick would be great.
Nick, wonderful. I always like to ask that so we can address you as you like to be addressed. So we're going to go through a series of 7 questions that we'd like to have your honest answers on. Are we ready for questions?
Go right ahead.
All right.
Can we introduce ourselves?
Probably good, yeah. Before I start with the questions, we'll go through and introduce ourselves. I am Nathaniel Waring. I'm the chair of the board.
Hi, I'm Crystal Drake Tremblay. I'm vice chair.
Nice to meet you.
I'm Dan Murphy McClark, newest member.
Great. Can you hear me well enough through the system?
Yes.
Okay.
Wonderful. All right. Thank you, Marvich. Our first question is, please give us your impression of Sunderland. Tell us why you want to work here and what you will bring to our town that may improve it.
Yeah, so I think my initial impressions of Sunderland are kind of a lot of people that attended UMass Amherst. I would assume you probably don't love to be thought of as a suburb of UMass Amherst, but during undergrad, I had some friends that went here, and certainly they lived here and things like that, and I would kind of travel through Sunderland on the way to Amherst for a number of years. But primarily, you know, I see Sunderland as a, you know, like a delightful little community within the Pioneer Valley, which is pretty characteristic of most of the Pioneer Valley. Sunderland, I think, represents an opportunity for myself. I'm looking at continuing work in local government, particularly at the administrative and manager level. It's really kind of a scalability thing. So right now, the town I work in is about 2,500 people, an operating budget a little over 9 million. Sunderland represents sort of that next jump within the valley. So there's a big gap between communities greater than, but less than, or greater than 3,000, but less than 5,000. So Sunderland's already kind of at the top of that. And then after 5,000, 6,000, 7,000, things start to kind of move in those larger managerial type positions.
Great. Thank you. Crystal?
What is the ideal role you seek for the select board in supporting the town administrator to address the community's needs? Conversely, what is the ideal role for the town administrator in supporting the select board?
So I think building that relationship at the onset is sort of the key in sort of understanding expectations. So I know that select boards can be sort of varied between community and community. Some prefer a more hands-on approach, I think. Some others might be a little more hands-off. And I think that sort of relationship, if you set the tone correctly at the beginning, you can kind of invest in that relationship and it'll pay dividends in the long run, where sort of the select board can use their strengths and the town administrator can use their strengths to kind of further the quality of life and the improvement in the community. But that's largely how I kind of see that relationship sort of developing off the get-go.
Thank you. Dan?
Yep. What approaches have you used or have you seen used to increase the number and diversity of volunteers serving on committees and commissions?
That's a good question. So I think one of sort of the strongest points of small towns is a desire of the community to volunteer and give back. But I think we have to be realistic and understand that that well is only so deep. And towns can operate sort of traditional sort of outreach methods. I often think that in small towns, particularly maybe a size like this, that word of mouth can actually be one of the best ways to encourage, you know, new faces and new people to join committees, especially if you're looking for persons that may be sort of outside of the, I guess I'll quote, the usual suspects. I think sometimes in small communities, you see a lot of the same faces on boards and commissions. And, you know, I certainly, bringing in more diverse opinions and points of view only furthers the work that these boards and commissions can do. But it's not an easy task, right? Like they're thankless jobs. They require time outside of your life to give to these things. So hopefully, you know, encouraging, so, you know, think of it as like a farm system, you know, and finding people that are interested in something, getting them involved and then kind of building them up to some of the more prominent positions, thinking like conservation, zoning board of appeals, planning board, sort of those larger footprint, you know, boards and committees. And that just takes time. I don't think there's any like magic stroke that says we're going to find every volunteer of every person we're looking for in this process.
Great.
Thank you. All right. Our fourth question is, Sunderland is challenged to balance the needs of for development to increase its tax base with the desire to maintain its rural agricultural community. As town administrator, how do you address the need to fund continued service delivery with ongoing funding limitations?
Yeah, I think many communities kind of struggle with this idea of like what sustainable development looks like to them, how that fits into the characteristics that they see their community kind of putting forward. I think largely that can start when I think of a community's most important piece of their puzzle, it often to me is the zoning ordinance or the zoning bylaw. So, you know, I can't tell you that Sunderland's zoning bylaw. Sunderland is actively committed to, you know, promoting and sustaining a certain, you know, rural farming characteristic while sort of looking for sustainable growth. I think if you invest the time and energy to make improvements to your zoning ordinance that are careful, thought out, and considerate, you can kind of set those guardrails for that development over time. And certainly ensuring that your zoning board of appeals and your planning board kind of represent those interests. I know that it looks like Sunderland has not completed a master plan or a comprehensive plan in some amount of years. Often that document feels to me like a very important sort of roadmap for a community. So actively seeking out and kind of doing that work, I think really sets the tone and the course for the Board of Selectmen as, you know, the leaders of the community that says, these are the things we really value, this is the direction we want to take the community, and we hope that people will help us get there. But I mean, you can take some legislative approaches, and I think primarily through refinement of your zoning ordinance and your zoning bylaw and making sure that it's thoughtful and measured.
Great.
Sunderland has an excellent team of employees. Describe the town administrator's role and relationship with department heads and staff. How will you promote communication and teamwork within and across departments and from town staff, including yourself and the community?
Sorry, can I just ask a clarifying? How many employees work in this building?
In this building, we probably have about 14.
14, okay.
Yeah, a combination of full-time and part-time.
Yeah, sure. So, you know, that's a good question. I think that as an administrator, what I do quite well is sort of a softer approach in sort of employee relationship building. So I'm the type of person that often comes into a new building or a new place of employment. I quickly learn names. I quickly learn a little bit about a person that allows to sort of build on a relationship that's at least grounded in some familiarity and sort of a friendliness. And I think what that does is it creates a comfortability between, you know, the administrator, maybe your assessor, your collector, any of these positions that, you know, are pretty, you know, common across these communities. So I think it starts there. And then I know it's critically important for the administrator to have sort of their eyes and ears on everything, whether or not they're like directly or indirectly involved in those things. So I do take the time to actually like move through offices, kind of check in and see how things are going, regardless if I'm asked to do such a thing. I think there's just real value in hearing directly from employees. And that can range, you know, just from like, how's the weather to, you know, I'm working on this great project that I need some support on and things like that. And I think it kind of comes out when you build a relationship that's at least a little bit founded in a sense of familiarity, a sense of comfort. And what that ultimately does, it allows you to create and promote accountability in the process as well. So, you know, I tend to take a more of a softer, you know, managerial approach in that regard.
Great, thank you. Dan?
Sorry. Understanding the town administrator's responsibility for handling multiple priorities at once, tell us what tools you use to organize your work when there are competing priorities and sometimes agendas.
Sorry, one second. Hey, Margaret, George is trying to enter. Do you mind letting him in? Thanks. Sorry, please go ahead.
So just repeat the question. It was about prioritizing sort of multiple.
Yeah.
Sorry, I
didn't mean that. Sure, I'll do it again.
Yeah.
That's right. Understanding the town administrator's responsibility for handling multiple priorities at once, tell us what tools you use to organize your work when there are competing priorities and sometimes agendas.
Yes, I think primarily with these jobs that they offer is, especially in the municipal calendar, sort of the rhythms and the patterns that we go through in terms of like getting ready to set the tax rate, getting ready to prepare for town meetings. So these things sort of have their place. And I think at the onset, if you sort of prioritize what you know are like the critical pieces that the can't miss, and then you kind of work backwards after that. So, you know, constantly administrators are sort of, you know, I don't think I've ever come into work and said, these are the things I'm going to do today and been able to check them off like in a systematic way. I mean, we just know that with these small towns, they're shoestring operations and the most unusual things happen. You know, the internet goes down. That basically sort of prevents any operations from occurring. So that becomes the priority. And those just take time. And I think at the end of the day, if you are, you know, aware of sort of the month of the year, what's on the financial calendar, what's on the community calendar, and things like that. You prioritize those big things. You prioritize those things that simply can't wait. We have deadlines to meet. We understand that thing. But in terms of like tools, I mean, it's largely sort of a time management practice of my own, right? You know, so I'll keep track of all the things that are ongoing, you know, and I'm constantly just having to make decisions to say like, well, this can wait another day. And at the end of the day, the work we do, is almost always going to be there the next day. So we just have to, you know, be kind of aware of those things, shuffle things as they arise, be responsive to the moment, to the situation, and just make smart choices. And, you know, it doesn't mean you can just let things fall to the wayside, but, you know, I think if you do the appropriate amount of shuffling and the right amount of awareness that you can kind of balance those things.
Thanks.
Great. All right, and our final question is, do you have any questions or anything else you'd like to tell us about yourself that you may not have already covered? That's the open-ended one.
Okay, about myself? Yeah, so I mean, just a little bit about myself, my professional history. So when I graduated undergrad, you know, I really thought I would be a high school social studies teacher, you know, one of those teachers that might be in a school for a long time. If you don't, you may or not recall the 2009-2010 labor market, especially in education, was like highly competitive. So that sort of dream never quite panned out, but I did develop over time a pretty interesting sort of unusual path in academics. And for a long time, I really felt like I never really hit my stride in sort of secondary education. And it wasn't until I actually left teaching to sort of pivot and build on the city council stuff that my colleagues sort of pointed out that they said, you know, Nick, even though you never really, you know, found your place, so to speak, your relationship with students is sort of unparalleled. And the work you do with them and the student development that you sort of, at the time, what I really didn't realize was I wasn't even aware I was doing those things. I was just kind of being myself, creating those relationships. And they turned out to be pretty profound in the way that like students still will engage with me like outside of the classroom like years later, just as like, and what that to me says is like I've carried a lot of that forward in my work as a city councilor. So, you know, I'm familiar with the legislative role, what that entails, you know, quite familiar with, you know, handling constituent concerns of a wide range of topics, you know, from the very mundane to the very complicated. And what that does, I think, over time has allowed me to put together a lot of really interesting pieces. Certainly my student relationships have influenced my management style, which I think is reflective in my current role. My work as a legislator at the city council level has, you know, I understand what the board of selectmen or the select board need to kind of do as the policymakers for a community and how to support them and, you know, how to move the community forward. Subsequently, you know, I made a choice to go back to grad school, you know, in a very untraditional manner. So I was 32 or 33 at the time. So I was one of the oldest students in my class, you know. But it gave me this like educational framework that I think is really valuable. I have a lot of skill sets that I can kind of bring to this and, you know, exercise in very interesting ways when allowed the space to do so. So I think in totality, you know, while I may have not seen this years ago, you know, my career has moved in a pretty interesting way, and I feel really comfortable like at this table tonight, knowing that I have a pretty interesting skill set. I really have a love and a commitment to local government. I just find that that's a field that needs more people involved, more good people involved in this process, and, you know, has been incredibly rewarding. It's somewhere where I hope to see myself kind of growing over the years. And what I like to think of is I have all these interesting pieces and parts of the puzzle, but I've yet to hit my career peak. So I think sometime, you know, in the next like, you know, 3 to 10 years, I think that's going to happen. And then a community that I've landed in where I'm hitting my peak, I think really kind of the sky's the limit for possibilities and, you know, promoting a better quality of life for its community.
Thank you. Do we open up for other questions from the board or?
No, we don't, not from the board, but if Nick would like to add anything else or ask any questions of the board.
Yeah, no, that'd be great. So
any questions for us?
Yeah, I got plenty. yeah, so I'd love to just, you know, either one or all three of you could answer, but I'd love to just get a better sense of like your relationship with the town administrator, what that's looked like over time. So I don't know how long you've been, you know, members of the board of selectmen, but.
So that's a very fair question. We are a very young board. Not necessarily in age, necessarily, but
well, maybe that's
especially
too.
Crystal. Crystal is the youngest one here. No, this is my third year of so the last year of my first term.
Okay.
Crystal is on her first year of her second term,
yep.
And Dan is on the second year of his first term. So none of us have been here for more than 4 years.
Okay.
Which is in some ways provides some challenges because you're a new town administrator coming into a group of people who aren't seasoned select board members per se. But also it gives us an opportunity on our end and on your end to be able to not get stuck in old, you know, ruts and not get stuck in old ways and be able to,
sure,
you know, forge your own path and whatnot.
Yeah, you won't hear a lot of, well, this is how we always did it, because we're pretty...
We're making it up as we go, you know. Okay. Now, the that being said, sorry, never mind. I can't ask questions. Go ahead. I had another question I was going to ask, but I'm not going to do that. Sorry.
Okay.
Anything else you want to know from our end?
Yeah, no, definitely. So I'd just be curious, you know, in your, you said about four years, everyone's kind of been on the board. Are there certain characteristics that you think make sort of, or have made a successful administrator in your eyes?
Yeah. So our, you know, and again, I've only worked with the previous administrator. I've known Margaret and, you know, I'm a lifelong resident here, so I've known the other town administrators, things like that. But for me, it was great with the last town administrator getting direction from him. Where, you know, if a problem arose and he could say, all right, well, when this happened in June of, you know, 2014, even though he wasn't here, it gave us a place to go back and look and see, you know, what, you know, you always have the ability to go back and grab notes or grab, you know, meeting minutes and things like that. And he was really, for me, really good at shuffling through that paperwork to get it for me, because obviously this isn't our full-time job.
Right.
All three of us have other full-time jobs, and as much as we would love to come sit here and rifle through all old paperwork and old meeting minutes, it wasn't always easy for us to do. So getting that type of support and direction from him, I really felt was, you know, for me, especially in the beginning, was wonderful.
There's a fine balance between providing your opinion on subjects and then also accepting whatever the board says and doing that wholeheartedly. And one of the things I really appreciated about Jeff was his ability to know when to give us his advice, know the bounds of that advice and not overstep those bounds, but also make us feel like we're supported and we're getting not just, oh, I'll do whatever you want. You know, he felt like he gave us good feedback in that respect. But when it came down to us making a decision, regardless of what it was, whether it was something that he necessarily would have gone that direction himself, he always executed that to the fullest extent of his abilities and professionally and whatnot. So that's obviously something that we're looking to continue with, you know.
Yeah, he was another... Again, we all have different personalities and stuff, and I'm not going to deny it. I'm a strong opinion, and
no,
but I don't ever want someone to back down from me. I want them to challenge me, because in my head I might be thinking, well, this is the only possible way to go, and I need someone to say, okay, but we can do this, and boom, 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 these are the reasons why, and give me that. I don't want someone that's just going to say, yes, Crystal, yes, Crystal. I want that challenge. I want someone to just, you know, not disagree with me for the sake of disagreeing with me, but if I'm wrong, you got to tell me I'm wrong, not, you know, just.
I'll agree with that, Crystal. It's kind of like open communication, definitely sharing your thoughts, and I really like responsiveness is great too. But yeah, the open communication and sharing your thoughts and helping to guide us, that's great.
Yeah, I don't know what we're at for time. Like, one more question, or
no? We got
yes,
we do have time for another question.
Yeah, I'd also just be curious if the board would elaborate on sort of either qualitative or quantitative metrics they might look towards to, you know, kind of see a demonstration of success in a position like this?
Ooh, that's a good question. So I'm not sure we're going to have necessarily a checklist with a bunch of rubrics that we're saying, oh yeah, he did that this year, he did that year. I mean, I think that the biggest one for me would be how successful budget season and town meeting are. You know, did we get everything done when we needed to? Did we have everything on time? Did we have to push town meeting back because things weren't prepared? That kind of a thing. You know, we're very low key in that respect. As long as the town continues to run and function well, you did a great job. You know, we're not looking to have some sort of high, lofty, you know, expectations. That being said, if you're looking to have good feedback from us to help improve your own performance and whatnot, that's certainly a conversation that we could have about coming up with some more subjective metrics to be able to track. And then the completely non-subjective one is how the other people in town interact with you, right? That's really the bottom line, is that you are going to be, or the person we hire is going to be, the first person, the front face of Sunderland and most communication with people in town, aside from Wendy, our clerk, and the other, you know, town officers and whatnot. And so we are going to judge that part of it by the feedback that we get from members of the public. You know, not to harp on Jeff, but we got good feedback about Jeff. We didn't, you know, have people saying, Jeff's, you know.
That was the previous administrator.
The previous administrator, yeah. Sorry.
I'm just filling in.
Ah, okay.
Sorry. Margaret's the interim.
Margaret's just our interim, yeah. I shouldn't say just.
Yes, and a former here in town.
Many hats in the last bunch of years for Margaret. But yeah, so really it's did the day-to-day operation of town get done? And were you polite and kind to people?
Sure.
You know, I know it's a low bar, but that's sort of the basement of where we go from there.
Yeah, and then the reality of it is, you know, the successful candidate is coming into someplace new, right?
Sure.
You know, there's things that no matter what, the successful candidate's going to know, town meeting has to happen. Budgets have to happen. But then, you know, it's kind of, what else with that time, you know, is there, you know, it's always great somebody who can, you know, think a little bit outside the box and go, oh, well, you know, there's grants or there's, you know, and figure out what that priority is. Because, again, you can apply for a million grants and you can get all these grants, but there's some reality base on that too, right? If you're going to, you know. It kind of all has to balance out, but not, no one's going to say to you, I don't think, at least from what I see in the near future, is, you know, we need X number of dollars in grants per year. That's, you know, I don't see things like that being any type of metric that, you know, we would really be looking to, you know, set some real definites on that. But obviously, you know, when they're available and it's something that, you know, can benefit us, yes. But I don't see a lot of real hard, you know, other than, you know, obviously the day-to-day running of the town.
Can I just want to add something, and it's just to support something that you said earlier. A town administrator is never going to come in and say, oh, I'm just going to accomplish this today. There isn't a day like that. There is always going to be something new happening on any given day.
Right.
So balancing the need to do budget projections and revenue projections and prepare the town meeting warrant, and those are the routine priorities, but there's always something else going on. And I think you might have been getting to that.
Yeah.
Those are the intricacies of the community that'll take a little time to understand.
Yeah.
One other thing I'd like to also add is that I valued in Jeff and in our future town administrator the ability to push back when I asked him to do something that was like, that's going to be 30 hours of my time. Do you really need that? Is that something that's really going to be helpful? Because there was a handful of times during contract negotiations, for example, where I'd say, hey, do you mind pulling this information? He said, well, I can. But just so you know, that's going to take me half of this week to do, and I can give you a basic guess right now that's going to be close enough, that kind of a thing. And so we do appreciate a certain amount of guarding of your own time to be like, no, my time, I only have 40 hours a week for the town, or I only have, you know, however many contract hours a week for the town. I want to make sure that I'm doing my due diligence with my time as well. So that's also an important thing for us as well.
Great. Thanks.
Dan, did you have any answer or thing to add on that particular one?
No, I'm good. I'm good. Sounded good. Thanks.
I think we have time for one more. Does that sound right?
You have anything else?
Anything else?
I think those are kind of the three I usually lead with. But
great.
Yeah, this is a great opportunity. I really appreciate you taking the time to interview me tonight.
Absolutely. And thank you for asking us good questions, because this is as much of an interview for us, for you, as it is for you, for us.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks. Anything else I need to?
Well, as far as timeline, just, you know, a little snapshot on the board's timeline. The board is conducting the final interviews tonight, finalist interviews tonight, and is expected to make a decision on a candidate to make a conditional offer to in the very near future, as there is a current vacancy here. So the board will be discussing that tonight, if they are ready to. So it's the process is going to move along.
Great. Who's the primary point of contact throughout the rest of this? Is it Deb? You?
Yeah, Deb and I would be the primary points of contact for you, just on a regular basis. Okay. Select board would be communicating with you should you be the successful candidate.
Yeah, that's really helpful. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. We appreciate your time.
Thanks, Nick.
Thank you.
Hey,
Booker.
Is it Nate?
Either one.
Okay. Like a
white maple.
Chris,
thank you. Great color.
I was
going to
say, it looks terrible.
Have a good night.
Nice seeing you.
Take care. Have a nice evening.
Thank you very much. All right. That went well. Any feedback for us in between candidates?
Are you okay with the microphone here?
Yeah, that's fine.
You are? And Dan, you can hear okay? Yeah, okay. All right.
He's on mute. We can't hear.
No, I'm good. I'm good.
As long as you can hear from that vantage point, then we're good. Okay. This is distracting to me, so I'm just going to shut this off.
Yep. It's not doing anything good anyways. Might as well make it go away.
I love the fact that you had an opportunity for discussion mm-hmm. at the end. I think that's really good. Do not hesitate to ask the finalists to follow up on your given question. If you feel that you didn't get a thorough answer, you could just say, "And what about yeah. this?"
Okay.
Okay. It's not straying from the question in that case. It's just asking them to elaborate a little further.
Yep, makes sense.
Good with that, Dan? Okay.
All right, so we've got Stephen McCarthy.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So, yeah, okay. So your next candidate, your next finalist is coming in. This is I'll introduce him as he comes in. I believe he's coming. Does the board have any questions for me while we are waiting?
Nope.
Okay. Doing good with time too. This is wonderful.
Oh yes, I'd much rather have to wait a couple minutes than end up being like, "I'm sorry, but we're gonna have to cut you off there." You know,
yeah, I know. I want to hear everything exactly, they have to say. Or run way over. So this is good. Mm-hmm. Very good.
Yep.
Let me just take a quick.
Do you give feedback to the candidates? No.
I typically don't, and I really shouldn't be chiming in so much. I just am trying to support what you're asking.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I was just curious. Do you know if we have a location requirement, you know, for them to live within?
I don't think we do. Just that it's in person is required, so it kind of depends on where they live and how far they want to drive. I liked having Jeff and Amherst, because then if we needed to come have an emergency meeting in our cul-de-sac, we could or whatever.
Right.
But I don't know that we made that a requirement.
Yeah, that's all right. Just to ask Margaret that before.
Yeah. I mean, our candidates are currently, at least three of them are currently working in towns that are within 10 minutes of us, yeah. you know, or 20 minutes for Williamsburg, but you know, Amherst and Shrewsbury are both close enough that if they're driving there, you know. Yeah. This will be the most riveting 15 minutes of FCAT ever.
Next appointment is at 7. It's 6:57. I think the candidate's coming into the building right now.
Beautiful. Excellent.
It's very quiet.
I know.
Yes.
Okay, I hear conversation. So I'm going to go ahead and introduce and start introducing Steve now. Again, his appointment is at 7 o'clock at 6:59. Stephen McCarthy is your next finalist. Steve has 7 years of municipal government experience in Amherst's inspection services and planning departments. He currently serves as Amherst's licensing coordinator and administrator for the Licensing Commission, having transitioned to his current position when Amherst moved to a city form of government in 2018. Steve serves as the chapter president and an executive board member of SEIU Local 888, representing 60 Amherst Town employees and 8,000 members as executive board member. He holds a bachelor's degree in political science from UMass Amherst and a certificate in municipal financial management from Suffolk University. Hi, Steve.
Hello. Hello.
Hi there. Welcome. Do you prefer Steve?
Prefer whatever. Steve's fine. Thank you.
He's fine. Wonderful. Alrighty. Thank you for the introduction. All right. Questions?
Introductions? Yeah, if you'd like.
So we'll start with the board introduction ourselves. I'm Nate Waring. I'm the chair of the board.
I'm Crystal Drake Tremblay. I'm vice chair.
I'm Dan Murphy and McClark.
It's a pleasure to meet all three of you.
Thank you. So we have seven questions for you today. We're going to ask them and ask that you give us your most honest answer you can. If you have any clarifying questions, we will ask you those. Our first question today is, please give us your impressions of Sunderland. Tell us why you want to work here and what you will bring to the town that may improve it.
So I grew up in a town called Westwood, which is outside of Boston. And I had never been west of Worcester in my life until I came out for UMass orientation in 2011. And I'll never forget, we got off the pike and I was driving through Belchertown. And I was with my mother, and we got stuck behind a lettuce parade. And there was a septic truck pulling a septic tank float that said, "Let us flush your pipes." And I turned to my mother and said, "What am I doing out here?" And here, 14 years later, I still find myself. You know, I really fall in love with the area. I love the mix of rural life with some culture and activity. And I've lived in Amherst for one of the last 10 or 12 years, and I always enjoyed spending time in Sunderland. Now, Sunderland was a place that certainly I drive through my way up to go to Massmoka or other things like that, but I've certainly taken the time to stop by some of the lovely places like Bub's Barbecue or the Blue Heron, and found myself really enjoying the small town feel that Sunderland has. And I think that Sunderland is beautiful community, the place where I'd like to do everything I can to help improve it and keep the functions of town government continuing.
Great, thank you. Crystal?
What is the ideal role you seek for the select board in supporting the town administrator to address the community's needs? Conversely, what is the ideal role for the town administrator in supporting the select board?
Well, I think the town administrator's role is to support the select board. So if I were to be selected as a town administrator, my role would be whatever is needed. Now, I've served in the town of Amherst as a staff support for the Board of License Commissioners. And that was a new board that was created after the town transitioned from a select board to a town council of former government. So the Board of License Commissioners handles liquor licensing, common victual licensing, a lot of the same things that a select board handles in a select board town meeting former government. And so I think that I have a good idea of a lot of what the select board business is. And my role would be to do whatever the select board needs, manage the day-to-day business of the town, work collaboratively with the department heads and the town staff and achieving the goals of the town, and supporting the select board whenever they need more information on proposals they may have, looking into questions, looking into the best way to do things, assisting in drafting regulations or bylaw amendments, assisting with any personnel issues that may come up, doing research into whether it be a search and rescue dog or PFAS leaking out of landfill, whatever issues may come up that I may assist with. And I think I would take my direction from the select board, the elected government of the town.
Great, thank you. Any follow-up on your word? Dan?
What approaches have you used or have seen used to increase the number and diversity of volunteers serving on committees and commissions?
Well, I know that seeking a diverse representation of all the people in the town is a very important challenge. And I know it's a very interesting problem in Sunderland, which has the highest proportion of renters of any town in the Commonwealth. And that is a challenge that I think I'd be well suited to assist with, trying to find representatives who are more the tenants rather than long-term landowners. And I think that's because I'm somebody who has lived that life. I came to Western Massachusetts without much family around here. I was a tenant. I was somebody who was new to town. And even when I was an undergrad, I tried to find ways to get involved in town government. I was in a fraternity in college, and I was elected to be the Interfraternity Council President, which is the governing board that manages all fraternities. And I knew that there was a serious problem with, you know, the perception of fraternities on campus, as well as some of the actions that some of them took that did not necessarily reflect well on the UMass student body. So I created a program to do a street cleanup, obviously a big complaint that many homeowners had in Amherst was that the college students would leave messes, they would leave trash, litter, and from my perspective as a tenant there, as a college student there, I created this program to organize the fraternities and sororities to go about the town and pick up the trash and pick up the litter in the some of the high traffic areas. And so having been a tenant myself, having been an undergrad myself in this area, I think that I would be able to speak the language, be able to interact with and try to bridge the gap between the town and Gown and between the landowners and the tenants to try to get more participation in town government from those who haven't been traditionally represented. And of course, I think that we also have to take a look at the cultural diversity of people who may be representing the town. I do have a decent proficiency in Spanish. That's something that has been helpful to me in assisting business owners in my position here in trying to bridge the gap between people who may not traditionally have been felt well represented by town government. And that's a skill I would use as well to try to communicate with people who deserve and deserve to be represented in town and may not have felt comfortable traditionally. So I think I would try to take creative approaches to reach out to different groups that may want to be more involved in town government. I know that there's some interesting things going on in Sunderland with tenants associations forming and some organization going on. That's something I would be excited to participate in to help the town as an organization bridge the gap between it and the people who live here.
Great, thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. Our next question is, Sunderland is challenged to balance the needs for a development to increase its tax base with a desire to maintain its rural agricultural community. As town administrator, how do you address the need to fund continued service delivery with ongoing funding limitations?
Now that, as mentioned earlier, that I really do like the rural New England feel of Sunderland and of many of the towns around, and I think that that is a perennial challenge that many towns face. And we've seen different approaches that different towns have taken. Hadley focused on creating a more defined commercial sector and retaining a kind of much more rural feel in the more outlying areas. I think that that's somewhere where zoning can be very important. But of course, I think we all know that tough financial times may be ahead. We live in an uncertain world, and maintaining our services, maintaining the paychecks for our hardworking employees, and maintaining the continuity of the town government is an extremely important challenge. So I would take a hard look at the budget, make sure that things are the money is being spent well, that all attention is being paid to everything it needs to be. And I would hope to work closely with the Select Board as well as the Planning Board and the Zoning Board of Appeals to take a close look at where in Sunderland there are growth opportunities, where there are opportunities for more commercial development, where those opportunities could be focused, and what actions could be taken to maintain our tax base while retaining the beautiful rural feel, which is what attracted me to be in the first place.
Great, thank you.
Sunderland has an excellent team of employees. Describe the town administrator's role in relationship with department heads and staff. How will you promote communication and teamwork within and across departments and from town staff, including yourself in the community?
I believe the most important role for a town administrator to play is that of a bridge maker, that of somebody who can facilitate conversation. And I think that the most important attitude to take is that of collaboration. So I've been working in the town of Amherst for 8 years. And in that time, I've held a couple different roles. Some of those roles I have coordinated the work of different people in trying to accomplish tasks. And I've also served as the president of our union chapter, as well as on the exec board of our union local, SEIU Local 888. And in that time, I've had a lot of experience coordinating different problems, because Amherst isn't a small town as Sunderland is, but it's still a pretty small town, and especially in the employee side, you get to know everybody. And in my role, I think I was able to see a lot of the communication that wasn't being made, a lot of the connections that weren't being made, a lot of the miscommunications that arise. I think a lot of conflicts in the workplace often come from miscommunication, and people's goals not being aligned. They may not have a good sense of what other people are thinking. And so if I were to be selected as a town administrator, I think my first priority would be to facilitate that communication, facilitate those kind of bonds, and make sure everybody's in the same place. I mean, I think it's important to take a hands-on attitude You know, the beauty of working in a town like Sunderland is that you can get to know everybody on a personal level. You can get to, you know exactly what everybody is working on. And I think that's the most important role for a town administrator to play, is if you have a good sense of the challenges everybody's facing, what everybody's working on, the struggles they may have, then you can get a good sense of, you know, if there are problems that come up, how those problems can be addressed. They often just come from miscommunication, and to try to facilitate those problems being solved.
Great, thank you. Dan?
Great, sure. Understanding the town administrator's responsibility for handling multiple priorities at once, tell us what tools you use to organize your work when there are competing priorities and sometimes agendas.
Well, that's something that I have a lot of experience in. In my current position, I serve as a licensing coordinator. So I not only support the Board of License Commissioners, I also oversee the rental registration program. I deal with different business owners who may be coming in and trying to start a business and helping them with whatever licensing they may need. I'll facilitate the communication between them and the zoning board and inspection services. And you know, there's a lot of different places that the business owners have to interact with town government to get their problems solved. So I have a lot of experience juggling different things. And on top of that, you know, I mentioned the union work I've done. So I often find myself juggling many different things, a lot of different conversations going on in the email inbox, a lot of voicemails to get back to. And I think, you know, taking a hands-on attitude is the most important thing in terms of specific tools I've used. You know, I think things we all know, to-do lists, keeping track of things in your email inbox. I know that Sunderland's lucky enough to have an administrative assistant within the select board and the town administrator, which can certainly help keep priorities on track. There's a lot of different things you need to use, because a lot of situations that develop in municipal government are very multifaceted. Something may come up, and there's a lot of different threads you have to chase down with looking into what regulations are, looking into how they may interact with state regulations, local regulations, trying to trace all those things down. So I guess to answer your fundamental question, I think there's a lot of different tools you have to use, and you have to be able to use all of them. I'm confident I'd be able to handle that.
All right, thank you.
Wonderful. All right, our last question is, do you have any questions or anything else you'd like to tell us about yourself that you would not have already covered?
A question I have is, I've reviewed a lot of the recent select board meetings in the town of Sunderland, and there's a lot of different things you guys are working on, but I'd like to know, what do you guys feel like are the biggest short-term and long-term challenges that are before the town?
That's a good question. One of the biggest short-term challenges that I see is budgetary concerns. There's been ARPA money for the last bunch of years that helped shore a bunch of town budgets up for the last 4 years, that is no longer going to be available. And that has largely hidden a budget shortfall for the last bunch of years that we are no longer going to be able to hide. So figuring out this coming year and years going forward, how to make that work within the confines of Prop 2.5, within the confines of the fiscal ability of the town to pay. That's, I think, our biggest challenge of anything.
I agree.
Anything you want to add, Crystal? Or?
No, I agree. I think that's going to be a tough.
Yep.
You know, that's going to be a challenge for us.
I'll second that. 130.
Yeah, short term and long term, because once you have a structural deficit, you know that's going to carry, and you have to do things every year to try to mitigate that structural deficit heading into the next year. So I think you could probably look at that challenge as a short term and a long term, yeah, a long term issue.
One of the other big issues that's not just affecting Sunderland, but it's affecting a lot of rural towns in Western Mass, is declining enrollment in the schools, increasing costs for transportation for students, things like that, where there's you know, a city like Boston's budget, the amount of money that goes to the schools, a small part of that. So if that fluctuates a little bit, it's, you know, not that big of a deal to them. For us, we had our busing go up by like 70% this last year or something like that. And that's all of a sudden like, well, what does a town do? And one of our biggest line items goes up by 70%. So yeah, budget concerns are really probably always going to be the biggest thing. Luckily, besides that, we don't have a lot of contentious issues in town, which makes my job a lot easier. But no, really, budget is and always will be the big one.
Yeah, I can really understand where you're coming from with the ARFA problem. I mean, I took a municipal financial management class this spring. Town administrator position is something I've been interested in for a while, and somewhere where I'm personally a little bit weaker in my work experience, I believe, is the budgetary side. So I took this course to try to shore up on that and get a little bit of a better sense, you know, how that all works and the best practices in that. So I was able to take different classes with you know, many different town administrators across the state and accountants, collectors, comptrollers, human resources, everything. And something that everybody was saying was the challenge that as ARPA is starting to dry up, I think a lot of towns are in that same position where there were some things they could afford and some holes they could plug for a while, but it is coming to an end. I think that's going to be a big challenge across the Commonwealth. And I think that on the municipal level everywhere, it's going to take a lot of hard work to figure out how to tackle that. And I'm curious to see why would the school bus budget go up 70% in 1 year? Was there?
So the short answer is that the contracts are negotiated. I think it's every 6 years or some arbitrary number of years. And the last time they had gone up was before COVID, before inflation, before all the things. And so we were getting a deal for a couple of years there. But like the ARPA thing, that was sort of for a bunch of years, we didn't have a real honest expectation of what the price, what the cost increase was actually looking like until it jumped up by 70% in 1 year, where if we had been more forward thinking those last 5 years or so, we could have maybe anticipated it more and had a plan. But yeah, I mean, even that being said, we were thinking 20%, we were thinking something like that. And then it came back at 76% or something horrible like that. It was like, well, I don't know what to say about that. But it also wasn't like there was other options that were cheaper. You know, there's only so many bus companies and there's only, you know, all of them raised their rates by a huge chunk. So that was a particularly out of left field kind of thing. But what we need to be expecting to see for the next chunk of years is with unsound inflation numbers, with supply chain issues across the world, with unstable political stuff in parts of the world and whatnot, you know, we need to do a better job in the future with preparing for the unpreparable, which I know is
hard to say. And the onus is on the town, to one of the board's last questions, the onus is on the town to look at any opportunity to generate revenue, to expand the tax base, to be able to absorb some of these unpredictable cost increases. So that is absolutely another challenge that would be long term for the town. It's not just visioning. It's more, you know, really visioning with a plan, really with a goal in mind that you're going to do something about expanding that tax base or generating revenues in some way. That, you know, credit to this board, they recently signed a host community agreement. There is going to be a recreational marijuana facility coming into town. That's just a small little piece of commercial development that Sunderland needs to broaden its tax base.
Yeah, and there is such an uncertain environment in municipalities these days. I mean, speaking of marijuana, that's something I've worked with as well. And I know that there's recently some changes to the equity and transparency standards in the CCC that reduced significantly the amount of money that a local municipality can take in from host community agreements. Right.
Yes.
That's something we've been dealing with in Amherst. And
yeah.
Oh, yes. We have some time for more questions. Do you have anything else that you'd like to ask the board about the nature of the town, our priorities, anything like that?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's great to hear the dedication you guys have to tackling these budgetary issues. I'm wondering, what do you guys think? I mean, Mr. Murphy, I read an article that you were mentioning, I think from a couple of years ago, about creating a multi-use, you know, bike lane coming up through, you know, kind of alongside North Pleasant Street and Amherst up to Sunderland. I thought that was a great, I actually know exactly the right of way you're talking about, because I'm a bike rider myself and I've ridden up there, almost got lost a couple times. I thought that was a wonderful idea. But I'm wondering, what are some of the ideas you all have about trying to expand the tax base?
So one of the things that we're in the middle of going through right now is a village center visioning project. Where we are trying to decide what we want to see the future of our village center. And so many towns' village centers is a beautiful little spot. Ours is, you know, a fly in a windshield through 116. Most people just fly on through town and don't stop. So one of the things we're looking into is how to slow traffic down, not just in terms of speed and safety, but in terms of making people look out their windows and notice, hey, there's a cute little shop there, or hey, I've never been to Blue Heron before, maybe I'll stop there, that kind of thing. So that's one of the things we're looking at is potentially a traffic circle, potentially some repainting, some trees, some you know, even just something as simple as a couple flags along the side as you go in there, give visual cues to people that, oh, this is a village center. This isn't just another stretch of 116. Yeah. So that's really one of the big things we're doing, is working on that. As you mentioned, Dan has been very involved in the shared use path, which is very exciting for us. The prospect of being able to have foot traffic from Amherst be able to come into town without having to have people drive in and park here, especially the UMass students, that opens up a whole slew of people who may not have transportation to get to town otherwise, but being able to come the bike path. Working with FRTA and the PVTA to try to, you know, make the bus routes work well for town also is a priority that we you know are looking at.
Yeah, development of this little park that we have here right now. We've had some grant money and stuff where we can put in pickleball courts, but then there's concerns from neighbors and where's the right place to put them and the noise and, you know, but again, we want reasons for people to come here into the center of town, and we want reasons for them to, mm-hmm. you know, this park here, it's a wonderful little walk, but there's things we can do to expand on it that might not actually bring the park itself. You know, hopefully you get the overflow that it brings money to Blue Heron, or it gives some of the other smaller places in the center of town the ability to increase their business. And
I think there is room to partner with the library on a lot of these things. One of the things that the library has done recently was add kayaks, a kiosk with kayaks that you can rent from them or borrow from them to use in that little section of the river, which are right behind the library. And that's the kind of thing that's going to bring people in. They go kayaking, they return the kayak. Well, they're hungry now. You know, they just got a bunch of exercise. Where they're going to go? They're going to go to the Blue Heron. They're going to go to
Sugarloaf Frosty.
They're going to go somewhere like that. Or they're going to stop at the corner store and they're going to get themselves a snack there. So that's the kind of thing that we're looking at, is how can we encourage people to get into town to begin with? And then while they're here, how can we make it obvious to them what there is to offer and get them to maybe spend a couple dollars while they're here? You know,
Riptide Growl, snow. Yeah. I mean, there's stuff here. Yeah. It's just, is your driving from UMass to get over the bridge to get on 91, do people even notice that Bridgeside Grill is there? You know, so it's getting that ability for people to actually see that there is something here. And
there's also, there's not a lot of places to park in town or that kind of a thing. And so the shared use path is a real opportunity to get people to come into town, because otherwise, people aren't staying in town. They're driving by, you know. I think all of those things are really helping to open the future up. Yeah. Dan, did you have anything you want to add? I don't want to leave you out.
Well, you guys covered it good.
Okay.
We'll take a look.
Yeah.
Those are really such good ideas. And it is a beautiful bike ride. I mean, I'm no Lance Armstrong, but, you know, it's nice and flat and level and easy to get to. And it is such a beautiful downtown. And I think all those suggestions are very well taken. I mean, I remember hearing a couple of your meetings, you were talking about adding some parallel parking, and there's a challenge with that, with it being a state road. But, I mean, it is such a beautiful downtown. I think there could be a lot of success in just getting people to stop and take a better look at it. And there's a part of me that would be sad to see that succeed, because the Blue Heron into a walk in the park is one of my favorite date ideas. But I think for the people of Sunderland, it would be better for if a little more crowded for me. Yeah. So. That's very interesting, yeah, and I'd be happy to help you guys along as you make those plans.
Wonderful. I think we have time for one more question from you, if you have anything else for us.
I guess I would ask, what brought the three of you to public service in Sunderland? What I don't know if you all three of you grew up here, or what made you want to serve in the select board? I mean, it's a lot of work.
I'll start, I don't care. I've lived in Sunderland my entire life. You know, we all had those few years during college and stuff where we moved away and, you know, thought we were going to live someplace else and have this, you know, wonderful life somewhere else. And I came back. This is my home. I grew up with, you know, just these family values of, this is the town that raised me and educated me, and you give back to the town. And, you know, I was on the fire department at one point. I was an EMT at one point, and this just became the next thing I figured I'd, you know, do what I can to give back to the town that I grew up in.
I made a mistake of coming to a meeting and then Tom convinced me to run. No, I'm kidding. I grew up in Shrewsbury up the hill. And so for me, Sunderland was always the town you drove through to get anywhere. Because if you're going to Amherst, if you're going to Greenfield, if you're going to Northampton, if you're going anywhere really in Shrewsbury, you drive through Sunderland to get there. And it was always just the most beautiful place to drive through growing up. I loved the fall and the leaves here. Sugarloaf Frosty was, we called it the greenhouse. That was like the place my family went for special occasions all the way through elementary school. It was always like the last thing we did summer break before the school year came back, is the whole family would go to Sugarloaf Frosty and, you know, do that experience. So I've had a love of Sunderland my entire life. And when I turned 18 and left the house, I did the thing where I lived in Hatfield for a year, lived in Greenfield for a year, and then came to Sunderland and 21 years now, I think, in Sunderland. Just love the town. It's an amazing town. I also am somebody who worked for 7 years in a horrible, horrible job, working as a Comcast contractor. It is just as bad as it sounds like it is. And that gave me a real appreciation for both how things can be run well by seeing how they aren't run well, and also a real, real strong labor ethic. I ended up becoming the de facto union rep for my guys, and then ended up suing my former employer and took Comcast to court and all that stuff. And on the tail of that, decided to run for state representative because I was all fired up and ready to change the world. Realized really quickly that's a lot more of a task to do. But it gave me a good opportunity to meet a bunch of people in politics. That's how I reconnected with Tom Feidenkevitz, the former chair of the Selectboard. And he, I think his exact words were, "You and I will work together someday." And then a couple years later, I think it was David Pierce was retiring, and I showed up to the meeting and Tommy said, "Hey, Nate." And I said, "I guess that's me now." So not actually the most, sexy story of getting here, but absolutely love the town. I would do anything for Sunderland, hence why I'm here. And also care a lot about how local government is run. I think, all politics is local. I can't change the way the world is. I can't change the way the country is, but I can certainly make sure that Sunderland's the best version of itself.
That's what really attracted me to local government as well.
Mm-hmm. And Dan?
Yeah. Came in 2000, raised a family here, fell in love with the town, and just started serving on boards. And as I learned more and met more people, they wrote me in a little bit, but now they decided to ask, I decided to serve on the select board because it was the next place to go after serving on planning, conservation, finance. Just love government, love the small town, and Sunderland's a great place.
If I could just add one other thing, and that's just that, one of the questions we asked you is how do you get a more diverse group of people to come volunteer for boards like the select board? And that is one of the things that I have seen as a real opportunity for growth in the town is getting more people involved. It's a little embarrassing to say that a lot of the times when we come to the spring time to nominate people for positions, we're having to like search in the hallway. "Hey, anyone out here want to be nominated for something?" Because there's just not enough candidates and not enough people who are interested. And so, for me, getting more people who want to be involved, maybe even having a contested election or two in the future, that kind of a thing would be a real, I think, boon for the town.
Well, Sunderland was very lucky to have all three of you. Those are very inspiring stories. Through a non-contested election or two, this town's very, very lucky.
Do you have anything that you'd like to add about yourself, Steve, before we conclude here?
Yeah, well, I guess another thing that attracted me to Sunderland is, I'm kind of an amateur mechanic, and I have a couple of cars I fix up. I actually bought one from my friend's dad, and it was sitting in his barn. I brought it back, and the oil pressure gauge was showing 0 PSI. And I figured that must just be a broken gauge or something. There's no way. It turned out no, it was 0 PSI, and I had never done much work on an engine like that before, but I wanted to drive it, and so I just got the book open and figured it out. And I didn't take it tonight because I thought it was a little greasy and might stain my seat. But I've been driving it all summer, and one of my favorite places to come is up 116 and then down through 47 because it is such a beautiful area. And I'm younger than some of the people you might have applying for. I have a lot of experience in Amherst, but not extremely broad based in other communities. And But I think I do have that hands-on, get-it-done type of attitude and the energy to help to do it. And, you know, the energy of the three of you is certainly contagious, and I'm very excited to speak with the three of you. And I hope that you'll consider me, and I'd be honored if you were to select me to assist you, because I think this is a great town, and it'll be very big shoes to fill with Jeff and Margaret. But
well, thank you very much. We appreciate you coming.
Would you like me to just recap the process? The board is going to be conducting the finalist interviews this evening. And then I because we do have an existing vacancy here, the board will be moving expeditiously to decide on a candidate that they would like to make a conditional offer to. One way or another, all finalists are going to receive word from the town as to the status of the board's decision.
Excellent.
Okay.
Well, it's really been a pleasure to speak with the three of you. Like I said before, your enthusiasm is contagious, and it really is. And I hope to hear back from you soon. But thank you very much. Let me speak with you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Pleasure to meet you too, Nathaniel.
Talk to you soon.
Nice to meet
pleasure
you.
Pleasure to meet you. Take care.
Great seeing you, Steve.
You too. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we've got 5 minutes for our next one. All right.
That was a nice discussion. I enjoyed hearing from the board too about your reasons for wanting to be board members. That's that was great.
Definitely a boon in his favor is the questions he asked were very well thought out, and I was appreciated them. So definitely a good thing. All right.
Well, we could have recessed, but today is my husband's and my 36th wedding anniversary.
Wow, congratulations.
I'm sure he's home watching something.
Okay. Well, he's not watching FCAT.
Congratulations.
Oh, thank you. Time flies.
Yeah.
Ben got his permit today.
Oh, yeah? What about Elsa?
Elsa got hers 2 weeks ago or so.
Oh, did you?
Yeah. So if you see the car driving really slowly around the cul-de-sac, stay far away from it.
So.
Who's up next?
Rebecca Torres.
Yep. Rebecca? Okay.
Yes.
Yep.
So I saw Michelle in the passenger seat, but I had no idea who was driving.
Today?
Not today. This was a couple weeks ago.
And that would have been also, yeah.
Going around the cul-de-sac real slow.
Yep.
And I thought, good for you guys.
I have to say, if we have to teach them how to learn to drive, having a cul-de-sac or having two cul-de-sacs to do it in is just amazing.
Because that's wonderful.
There's like 3 cars a day that pass in front of our house, and as long as she avoids those 3 cars, she's fine. Yeah. But yeah, both of them are learning now. They're going to start LeDuc up in Greenfield this winter. Do their driver's ed test. Apparently, us parents also have to do a driver's ed class as well.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, they've changed that rule.
Oh, no.
I remember those days, though.
My kids won, I had to go.
Did you really?
Yep. It's only one night.
Yeah.
It's so long ago for me.
So
I just don't know.
My kids went right on Main Street. There was like this little strip mall, Herm's restaurant or something used to be in there. And
okay, we have our next finalist. Hi, Becky.
Hi.
This is Rebecca Torres. Becky currently serves as Shutesbury's long-term town administrator, having held the position since 2009. Prior to becoming the town administrator, she served as Shutesbury's select board chair from 2002 to 2009 and as its finance committee chair from 1994 to 2000. Becky holds a bachelor's degree in economics from UMass Amherst.
Good evening, everyone.
Welcome.
Wonderful. Thank you for having us. So I'm gonna start off.
The only one that bought this bright green.
That's amazing. Before we start, we'd like to just introduce ourselves. I'm Nate Waring, the chair of the Select Board.
I'm Crystal Drake Tremblay. I'm the vice chair.
Good team.
I'm Dan Murphy, the clerk.
Hi, Dan.
So we have seven questions that we're going to ask you today. We'd like to have you give us as best of an answer as you can give us. Be honest. And if we have any follow-up questions or anything like that, we will ask them. Or any clarifying questions. Our first question is, please give us your impressions of Sunderland. Tell us why you want to work here and what you will bring to our town that may improve it.
I think the best way to start is, I was talking to my mom about Sunderland, and she said, you know, the nicest people live in Sunderland. And I was, you know, living in Shutesbury, in the neighborhood, Sunderland has always been a destination point or, you know, things are happening here, but you've got such a mixture of an agricultural community with the professionals commuting into Amherst. You've got all the student populations. One thing Shutesbury has some of, but not to the extent. The housing facilities that you provide for our extended community really make a difference. And to be able to do that and still maintain a residential suburban feel and with all the students here is a remarkable thing. And I think for me, having been in Shutesbury a long time, most of the major projects I've worked on are coming to fruition, and the challenges here seem exciting because it's facing the reality of growth and learning how to accommodate the different needs that people have for services, but also for keeping zoning using zoning to keep growth from destroying the values that people have here. And it's been clear that work has been done to hold on to history, to hold on to the rural character. You've got so many fields behind suburban developments. You've got opportunity for, you know, more growth, but I'm sure it has to be very carefully done. And the last part of the question was, how might I impact that? I think.
Yeah.
I think I would work to listen to the vision of the population, to help support the Select Board in their needs to take on new projects. I know that you're faced with development, economic development, but how you respond to it, how zoning can be utilized to really build protections and structures. I noticed you also had a battery, solar battery, on your amendment to your zoning this year. So it's clear that protecting the people is important. And protecting the land is important. I know the people are concerned about solar and its potential to devastate and erode a population, but it's a fine balance of appreciating solar and making sure it's done correctly so you don't end up with the erosion problems or any other disasters from utilizing that development. So I think I would be a bit of a watchdog on zoning and checking in with your planning board, making sure that any development is done carefully and productively for all your goals.
Great, thank you very much. Crystal?
What is the ideal role you seek for the Select Board in supporting the town administrator to address the community's needs? And conversely, What is the ideal role for the town administrator in supporting the select board?
I think an ideal select board would be one that is inspired by your work. It's such a taxing job. It's hard to maintain that excitement sometimes. But I think this community hopefully has been supportive of your work. You need to get the word out about what you're doing. And messaging is very important. I think the town administrator can help facilitate that and make sure press releases go out and people are aware of the beneficial things that the community, you know, the town is doing. The select board, I've always felt it's the toughest job because you have to put your personal issues aside to some extent. You have to think first of the town. You have to think through what's best for the town, and it might not agree with what you personally want to do. But that double check, when you have a strong select board, they are town focused above their own concerns. As far as what I would hope to do as a town administrator is really bring together the volunteers and support them, as well as each employee and individual that is working for the town. In Shutesbury, we have an army of volunteers, and I'm sure you have one here. It is really important that you keep them in mind when you're creating committees, knowing when to create a new committee. Hopefully the town administrator can alert you to developments that you might not see, or you can alert me to develops the town administrator is missing.
Thanks.
Great. What approaches have you used or have you seen used to increase the number and diversity of volunteers serving on committees and commissions?
That was a great segue.
I know. It was like, that next question is going to flow.
Great segue.
Okay, methods. Well, this was kind of accidental, but we've had the transition of our three major department heads. Our fourth one is coming up, the library. But in the last 4 years, we have replaced a longtime police chief with a new younger person to some extent who really is believes in community policing. She has been inspiring to a number of people that have come out and started coming to meetings. We had a police study committee before she became chief, and we drew a lot of new people out in those discussions. And some of them have continued on and volunteered for other things. Our new fire chief, Lenny Zawanka, has also been recruiting, working with the library. He's been attending different library events, and we have found people, you know, he has brought in four new volunteer firefighters, and that has been a godsend. Getting new firefighters in this day and age in our community, which is probably similar to yours, when you don't have people at home very often. Some people work remote, and we've been able to tap into those folks a little bit. So that it's been a younger mix of people, but it's been bringing in new people. And then finally, the highway department. Also, we replaced a longtime 20-year veteran in the highway department. And we've brought in the new person. He's older, but has attracted new young people to that department. I think overall, all of our committees are gaining ground in younger people. I think that there's been, since COVID, there's been a renewed sense of volunteerism, it feels like. We had a lot of people move into town We hadn't had much turnover in housing prior to COVID. We did not, our internet service was turned on in January of 2020. Thank goodness.
is that a fiber network? Or?
Fiber network. Okay. Shutesbury.net went live December and January of 2020. And it was just, I don't know how we could have gotten through. We couldn't have held Zoom meetings. We couldn't have, you know, people were around the lake were still on dial-up. It was a miracle. And it's also brought in a lot of people that weren't able to move to Shutesbury because we didn't have internet. So I think it's diversified. You all are using Comcast. You were able to get traditional cable TV, which we were jealous of for decades. But right now we were able to reduce our rates to, I think, $75 a month. And we're feeling in control of that. And I don't know where the future is for cable, but the initiative to build your own network is another possibility, yep, if needed.
Thank you.
Cool. All right, our next question is, Sunderland is challenged to balance the need for development to increase its tax base with a desire to maintain its rural agricultural community. As town administrator, how do you address the need to fund continued service delivery with ongoing funding limitations?
Well, the other difference between Shutesbury and Sunderland is your commercial base. We have, 50% of Shutesbury is forest. We get some money from the state, but we have no commercial base. Our tax rate was sitting at 2404 for just 3 years ago. We have seen growth in values, so our tax rate has come down, but we're still in a pickle there. Sunderland, having the commercial base potentially, could build from that. Solar pilots are another potential option. That's the only one Shutesbury has. I think also your school is probably your largest expense, probably about 60% of your budget from what I saw.
Mm-hmm.
Changes in funding are really necessary from the state. You know that we're always hoping it doesn't happen. But I think working together and figuring out different ways to consolidate, Amherst is struggling. Their brainstorm of the week is to move the middle school into the high school. But they're desperately looking for a $4 million fix this year. So gaining, if we're able to find a way, there's a lot of pressure on the state to find a way for education because across the board, the regional schools were in trouble this year. So hopefully there'll be some solutions coming there, but other revenue streams, I think we'll have to look, making sure that all your parcels are fully being taxed appropriately is a concern. I did not determine who you're using as your assessor. Typically, consultants have been brought in when you don't have an administrative assessor. I don't know your situation there because I didn't see an administrative assessor or a consultant, so I'm not sure.
I think the assessors use a number. We are using, I believe, Patriot Properties at the moment for the cards, and there are a few other consultants that the assessors are working with for inputting building permit data into the assessor's system and things like that.
Okay. Yeah, you just want to be sure that you're fully
capturing
every dollar that is due. Absolutely. You, and that would be a top priority to review. I already had a little conversation with Margaret about your tax collection, which I guess was struggling for a little while, but you seem to have come to terms with that, and that's great. Shutesbury's been spoiled. We just had to extend our longevity to accommodate 50-year longevity because of our tax collector. She's been running a 99% collection rate for 40-some years. So that's always a good thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Wow.
Okay.
Sunderland has an excellent team of employees. Describe the town administrator's role and relationship with department heads and staff. How will you promote communication and teamwork within and across departments and from town staff, including yourself, to the community?
Staff is critical. They need support at all times. I have an open door policy in Shutesbury. It takes more time, but I make it a priority to stop and listen. Department heads don't come if they don't have a reason. And I think it really helps foster respect and understanding. Employees are the backbone of your work. The select board support of your employees is critical. And you must be doing it or you wouldn't have such a good team of employees. Employees are in municipal work, tend to be workaholics and more dedicated than some other people. So you have to sometimes make sure they're taking care of themselves. And check in that way. You want to make sure people don't work themselves too hard.
Yep.
I have worked a lot with our highway superintendent and the department, so we've worked on different projects and getting to know the crew is really important because I always have somebody I can get an answer from. And it's a small town, so you can't know the superintendent without knowing the whole crew there. You have a similarly sized highway department. It's like three or four individuals. And so which is remarkable because you have 45 miles of road and I think we only have about 30. The difference being we have half dirt roads. And I couldn't figure out how many miles of dirt roads you have, and I don't think it's very many.
Not very many anymore.
It's the couple up 47.
Well, maybe not as much as Shutesbury.
Right. But I think teamwork is critical. You have to bring people together. And I think that having department head meetings regularly really will help sustain that. I imagine it's probably being done. And as far as brainstorming for bringing the people together, we have regular emergency management meetings quarterly now. We used to have them monthly, but we didn't have the need, luckily. I think that's another area where the select board working with the department heads on that, it really helps make people ready to act when you do have a problem. Because you're already familiar, you know each other, you've probably done different projects together. So there's a lot of ways to bring people together.
Okay. Understanding the town administrator's responsibility for handling multiple priorities at once, tell us what tools you use to organize your work when there are competing priorities and sometimes agendas.
Well, just basic to organize the work, just basic calendars and project lists and with priorities stated. But most importantly, like on a given day, it's really difficult to achieve that list you wrote the day before. I mean, I at this point, I write a list for the week because I can check off maybe three items a day because there's new things, new developments, new problems, new phone calls that have to be attended to, and then try to catch up early mornings on things that you can't get done when the door is open.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Wonderful. All right. Our last question is a little bit more open-ended. Do you have any questions or anything else you'd like to tell us about yourself that you may not have already covered?
I want to brag about one thing.
Please do.
Well, 2 weeks ago, my mother, again, my mother, was named the oldest person in Leverett. The select board came out and awarded her a cane pin. And it was so lovely. And you have the original cane.
We have the actual
cane.
Yes. Yeah, we have one of the canes.
Oh, that is so marvelous. No, Shutesbury lost their cane quite a while back. So that is wonderful.
So we actually, when we award it, we bring it, they get it, like for their birthday party celebration and stuff. But then we have to go get it back so we can.
We maintain the stewardship.
We kind of keep it.
The idea of the pin is lovely.
That's ongoing, but it was really a wonderful event. The Leverett Select Board came and spoke with her, and it was
just—it
was great. I don't know why that came to mind, but.
Oh, but that's a small town thing that you don't see in.
No, and when we got the opportunity to go give out the cane, was it last year? That was one of the highlights of my time.
Yeah, I've done it twice.
Yeah. I've only done it this last time, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's definitely one of the fun things. And that's one of the nice things about Selectboard is a lot of paperwork, a lot of budget, a lot of stuff like that. But every now and then you get to do something
it's
kind of fun.
Yeah.
You know?
A good social people thing.
Yes. Do you have any questions for the Selectboard? Anything you'd like to know about the town? Anything you'd like to know about us in particular? Our priorities? Anything?
Have you all established a list of goals for the year or?
We don't necessarily do a.
Well, this year we haven't had a town administrator for 3 months. I'm sorry.
No, it's a fair question. And honestly, no, we haven't. I think largely our goals have been to keep the town running. And if we accomplish that and we have 5 minutes after that to do something else, great. But it's a good question and a good thought for once we do settle on a town administrator, sitting down and having that conversation with the town administrator, to figure out what we do want to accomplish.
Yeah, I mean, I think we have things that we know are kind of sitting on the back burner, kind of waiting, because they'll take, you know, it's not fair to Margaret as an interim to say, hey, start running with this when she's not going to be here long enough,
yeah,
you know, to follow through. And it's just, you know, with limited time and stuff, you know, like we have grant money and funding to put pickleball courts in here at the Riverside Park.
Yeah.
But then there's some controversy over the noise and the abutters. And, you know, and unfortunately, it's been a problem in many communities, right, with the pickleball courts and the noise. And like, that's something we really need to find a solution for. You know, we need to figure out what the best way to proceed, because the town wanted it. There's the grant money. There's things like that that are kind of sitting on the back burner until we have somebody that can take control of those and run with them. You know, we were talking about, there's a visioning for the center of town. How do you turn the center of town into a center of town where, you know, you having been a longtime person in this area, you know, just looking for ways and a new set of ideas, you know, because a lot of these people have been working on this for a long time. So I think there's always this list of things that we just haven't been able to prioritize right now because we need somebody, you know, to be able to say, okay, this is, you know, what we'd really like to see next happen.
I would like to see us as a board get to a place where we're a little bit more preemptive than reactive, right? Where we're rather than just, what are we dealing with now? Whatever disaster fell in our lap this last year, like, oh, it's the budget, oh, it's this, oh, it's that. I'd much rather get to a place where all that stuff is much more sort of settled and you know, don't worry, it's moving along, to give the board more opportunities to think those big questions of what do we want to do. We spend a lot of our time figuring out how we're going to balance the budget or figuring out how we're going to be able to, you know, overcome issues with the school or overcome issues with the departments and whatnot. It's definitely a goal of mine to get to a place where all of that is 60% of our time, and we have extra effort and time and energy to be able to think about the improvements of the town. Things like the visioning, that's great, but what's the next thing after that? We don't know yet because we're not thinking about it yet. So, like, you know, having that, not just the immediate thoughts in mind, but also what's our 5-year plan, what's our 10-year plan, what's our 50-year plan, you know, what's the town going to look like in 50 years? I have no idea. You know, if we went back 50 years and asked the people 50 years ago what was Sunderland look like in 2024, it's not going to be what it looks like today. And so trying to figure out how to make plans for things like roofs on schools and that kind of thing. I'd like us to get to a place where we have more capacity for that kind of thing as well. So it's a goal. Dan, did you have anything you wanted to add?
Well, I think we're doing good. Coming up with I love the idea of a comprehensive plan at some point in the future.
Yes, that is a really good point too. A comprehensive plan, or updating the master plan, or at least phasing master plan chapter updates.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, I think that would go a long way to this long-term visioning, long-term planning in town. Yep.
When was the last update to the master
plan? I think it's been, I think the housing production plan probably would have been the most recent one because of Sugarloaf Estates, because of the large...
Sanderson?
No, the large scale development down near the line. I think that probably was addressed back then, but all the different chapters need to be looked at and updated.
And also just...
116 flats.
Also for context, we're a very new board, 4 years, 3 years, and 2 years. And so there's a lot of maturing that the board is doing also. And so one of the advantages of having a new town administrator coming in is it gives both sides an opportunity to sort of start from the ground up and be able to not rely heavily on how things have been done for a long time, but more get a chance to discuss how things should be done in the future and how we can improve on things and whatnot. So there's definitely some excitement there for that kind of thing as well. Any other questions for the board?
The 55 and housing area, where is that going to be located?
That is Sanderson Place. So that is constructed. It's not fully valued yet, which is interesting. I've been on that.
Yes.
But it is constructed and occupied. So that is located just a little further down 47 from the Blue Heron.
Okay.
And it's a beautiful development. It was developed kind of in harmony with the agricultural rural feel of the community. So
it's honestly, the views from that building are amazing and make everybody jealous, because at one side you look and you see Mount Sugarloaf and the mountain range and you have beautiful, you know, sunsets and sunrises or whatever direction that is. And then the other direction is just out into these open, beautiful fields that just go out behind the Heather Place condo. But it's just amazing location. The residents there are very lucky. We got the opportunity to go there and I was very impressed with it.
I had a resident come in about a week ago who told me how lucky she was.
Mm-hmm.
She just wants to stay in her unit and just look out the window. She says it's absolutely gorgeous. So I think we have some happy residents there.
Which does raise a question that, you know, in town is how do we increase the number of available units for seniors, because we have an aging population, many of whom would like to stay in Sunderland long term, may not necessarily be able to do that in their houses long term. So how do we improve our stock of over 55 housing, subsidized housing, that kind of thing, in order to be able to keep Sunderland the place that these people are able to age in place in? So that obviously the Sanderson Place is a huge deal for us because that's a bunch of units, but that's not the end of the story. That's, you know, the beginning of the story for us about how to figure out how to get more housing like that. And that's a great example of a place where grant money and a bunch of community organizations and Sunderland, you know, members of the board and members of the planning committee and about that all came together to make something quite unique and amazing happen. So definitely a footprint for what we can do in the future in that respect, for sure.
To do more.
Yeah.
That's very exciting. And everybody's looking at their watches?
No.
Okay.
We're just looking to see if we have time for another question or where we are.
Yeah, just be respectful of our next candidate time. I mean, no, we definitely still have good old 6 minutes or so. So if you have any other questions for the board?
The Frontier, your relationship with Frontier is a pretty straightforward agreement where you just split the assessment costs.
Yep, it's done by number of students attending, so it fluctuates year to year based on how many students from Sunderland are going, but also the three other towns. But yeah, it's a straight, I think Sunderland's share usually ends up being right under 30%, mm-hmm. like 27, 28, 29, something like that percent. But yeah, sometimes that goes up and down. And then we do also have a relationship with Franklin Tech up in Turner's Falls. We have a number of students who go there. Both my kids are actually going there currently. And so we also have assessments that come out of Franklin Tech, as well as the normal school choice and whatnot.
Yeah, then we have South County EMS, our ambulance. You know, we have an assessment on that, the senior center. So, yeah, we have a few things that are regionalized besides just the school.
Yeah.
From a town administrator standpoint, though, a lot of the administration of the tri-town, quad-town organizations falls under Deerfield's purview.
Okay.
They're the largest town, and they do all the personnel stuff and that kind of thing.
And they all reside in their town.
Yeah, and exactly. They're physically located in that
town. Or at least the senior center was prior.
And that's not to say there isn't a certain amount of work involved with maintaining that relationship and whatnot, but a lot of the day-to-day running of those departments luckily falls outside of our borders.
Yeah, that's why I was noting that some of the work done in Shrewsbury, like the fire department and the council on aging, you have.
Yep.
Administration of. We've had this ongoing issue in the Amherst region where Shrewsbury had finally successfully about 4 or 5 years ago gotten the region to adopt the statutory formula. And the reason for the push was we have great disparities in wealth in the four towns in that region. In the Frontier region, it seems like people are pretty much on an even footing. Like if you're 30%, maybe Deerfield's 40.
Deerfield's closer to 50. Yeah. We're in like the 30-ish or 25 to 30-ish.
Yeah, but the second largest community in Frontier. Yeah.
Is it an issue in your community, do people argue about assessments or they get along well?
So I think luckily the four towns are very equally situated financially, both in terms of our town budgets and also in terms of the average wealth and the average income and the average,
it's very similar.
Not perfect by any means. Yeah. I think if you talk to Conway, they might disagree with us a little bit on that. But we don't have necessarily the same kind of discrepancy. I know the Amherst school system very well, and Amherst is this huge thing with UMass and all these colleges, and they have piles of money. And I know that an Amherst town administrator might argue with me about how much money they have, but compared to Shrewsbury, Leverett, or Pelham, they absolutely have piles of money. And so I certainly understand that dynamic is wildly different, luckily, than our dynamic. There's not, at least in my 3 years here, there hasn't been any contention between the towns about any of these items. I think largely the way we have it set up is equitable and fair in a way that all four towns agree on. And because of that,
I think we see it probably the most with Tech, with Franklin County Tech.
Mm-hmm.
Because, again, that's a bigger, and I don't think it's contentious, but the Sunderland's assessment per student ends up like higher maybe than Athol and Oranges and Wendell. Yeah. And
last year we were like three times at Oranges assessment per student because of the income difference.
Yeah.
Which, and to be honest, this is going to sound weird coming from the person whose job it is to manage the budget of the town, is fair. We have more money in town. The average person in Sunderland has more money in town than the person in Orange does. And so I'm not necessarily arguing with the fairness of that. But when it does come up, that's one of the things in town meeting people go, well, wait a minute, why are we paying three times as much as they are, that's at the Franklin Tech level, that's more of an issue. Luckily, we're not talking about a huge volume of students, 10 students or something like that go to Tech from Sunderland. So it may be a small contentious point, but nothing
But that's where we see that income disparity is more at Tech than
outside of the South County when you start to go to the larger Franklin County population, Sunderland, Deerfield, Whately, and Conway start to flow to a different side of the total equation.
That's good.
Yeah.
One quick question.
Oh, please.
The role of the select board in the budget. In Shutesbury, primarily the finance committee handles the budget and presents it at town meeting. They take, you know, they work, you know, the select board reviews it and they have conversations about it, but for the most part, it's handled by the finance committee. And I don't know if it's the same here or not.
I would say that the select board is a lot more hands-on with the budget in our end.
Which it is in a number of towns.
Yeah. I mean, I would certainly approve of leaning on the finance committee a little bit more on something sometimes, you know. Anything I can shift off of my plate under them would not be a bad thing. But that being said, December through March for the select board is busy. A lot of meetings, a lot of things to talk about, a lot of discussions about things like capital projects, you know, so. Yeah, we do have a capital planning committee that has a member from the select board, a member from finance, a member from planning, a member from a bunch of other departments and whatnot, that makes suggestions to the select board in general. But a lot of the finance committee has their say in everything, but a lot of stuff comes through us either concurrently or before it goes to them or whatnot. So definitely a lot more involvement than I would say that you're used to in Shutesbury. Not necessarily a bad thing.
But the town administrator will play a critical role in assisting the finance committee with the budget document, bringing it to the select board for review and discussion, organizing the budget meetings and
right. And
everything.
Just keeping that running total of where we are, you know.
Mm-hmm. How many tens of thousands do we need to shift around? You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And our last town administrator, Al's have to say, was great at that. Was, you know, every week he had an update with, you know, all right, you know, we got a deficit of this many hundred thousand, and now we just closed it, and, you know.
I have to say, one of the things that is going to be a good thing for us is that we had some issues with accounting in the past that made it hard for us to do the budget because we'd get town, the free cash would be certified like a month before town meeting. We have switched to a new accounting firm, Aponte and Aponte. They have been wonderful. They've gotten us up to date. They've been Johnny on the spot about things, and we are very confident going into this next couple of budget seasons that we're going to have free cash certified much earlier, that we're not going to have to try to...
Free cash just got certified. If I had a report tonight, I would have
said... It's amazing! Which, I mean, this is literally 6 months before we were... Mm-hmm. 2 years ago, it was February. It was literally February, like 23rd or something like that. It got right. We actually had a conversation about pushing back town meeting because we weren't sure we were going to have free cash certified by then. And so the good news is we're past that particular bumpy stretch. And so we actually have really good accountants that do a really good job of getting us that information, as you can see, in October, which is fantastic. It gives us a lot more breathing room for the budget. And so I'm very confident that it's going to be a good year.
So we're going to have to wrap it
up. Sorry.
I'd like to though, just give a very brief recap about the board's process. So obviously there is a vacancy in the town administrator position here. So the board is going to proceed without delay in discussing their options moving forward and offering conditional employment to a finalist. One way or another, all finalists are going to hear from us with the status of the board's decision. And I think the board just is going to proceed without delay.
Yes, we're going to try to do our due diligence as fast as possible.
Yes. Thank you for my interview.
Nice to meet you.
And I love your choice.
Look at that.
That's what I said. I said
matchy, matchy. Bye, Becky. Nice seeing you.
Have a great one.
Thank you. You too.
Hers seemed to show up on the camera like not as traffic. You know, like the best they wear in the traffic.
The high visibility.
Yeah.
The woman. Walking all around the field out there, I could have lent it to her.
Take care, Becky. Nice seeing you.
All right. So our last one is going to be Andrew.
Yes.
Wonderful. This has gone very well.
Yes, I think it's fabulous discussions.
As soon as I hear footsteps coming up here, I'll start the introduction. Keep us moving.
Sounds good.
The board's next finalist is Andrew Levine. Andrew Levine currently serves as the chief of staff in the city of Newburyport. He's been in this position since January of 2022. Prior to this, his public service experience goes back to 2016, where he served as the town of Billerica's Director of Administrative Services, Operations Officer, and Program and Project Manager of the Transformative Development Initiative at the Massachusetts Development Finance Agency, and as a Dukakis Summer Fellow in the Governor's Office. Andrew holds a master's degree in public policy from Harvard University's John F. Kennedy School of Government and a bachelor's degree in government with minors in theology and Italian from Georgetown University. Welcome, Andrew.
Well, thank you.
Thank you for joining us today. I'm going to start off with some introductions. I'm Nate Waring. I'm the chair of the select board.
I'm Crystal Drake Chamblay. I'm the vice chair.
I'm Dan Murphy, the clerk.
Wonderful. So we have seven questions prepared for you today. We're going to go take turns going around and asking them. If we have any clarifying questions that we'd like to ask to clarify something you said, we will do so. But otherwise, we're just going to go around and start asking some questions. All right. Our first question is, please give us your impression of Sunderland. Tell us why you want to work here and what you will bring to our town that may improve it.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to interview tonight. I've enjoyed the best process so far, and it's been great meeting Deb and Margaret, and I really appreciate the opportunity to meet all of you and to get to learn more about you in Sunderland. So I try to do my research as best as possible. I've read your annual reports, your budgets, and if there's really one way to know a town, it's by reading their budget. To a certain extent.
So you were scared.
There you go. I actually really appreciate the challenge statement that you put together as well, because I think it summarized, you know, how you think of this community and how you think of some of the challenges that are facing it right now. And, you know, in my career, I've been able to work in a lot of different communities. As Margaret was saying, I worked in at Mass Development, where I worked across the state in the gateway cities, which brought me out to places like Fall River, New Bedford, Chicopee, Lawrence, Springfield. And then I worked in Billerica, Mass, and then Newburyport. This would definitely be the smallest community I'd work in, but I think there's a lot of things about it that really intrigue me. First of all, the rural identity, and really just an overall sense of understanding what this community looks like to the residents, people who choose to live here or brought up here and want to raise a family here. A real sense of identity of what kind of place it is, while at the same time understanding that identity is in some ways changing, is in some ways potentially, depending on your perspective, threatened. That's something that I've dealt with a lot in Newburyport, which has been fascinating. It's a long-time blue-collar town that doesn't really look like that anymore. It has a lot of people who've moved in and think of it as a more of a bedroom community, and I think that's an identity issue that Sunderland is in some ways dealing with. So I like working in places that both understand who they are, but are also interested in, you know, preserving what they have, but meeting those interesting development challenges head on and finding ways to help the residents who are already there and those who want to be there make the best community that it can be. I'm a public service professional. I care about working in communities that can thrive with everyone working together. And the other thing that really drew me to Sunderland is the social capital here. It looks like you've got really strong boards. You've got great volunteer spirit. Town meeting looks like it went pretty quickly, which is nice from a spirit of community engagement and early working together, collaboration. You know, that's something that is a little bit missing in some of the towns I've worked in recently. And there's some strong social capital in some of them, but it's not necessarily about what can we do together. It's often about how can we get our way. And I think for a first opportunity to be a town administrator, I'd love it to be somewhere where we're thinking about how can we make this a better future for all working together. And I'm sure I'm sugarcoating some of the divisions that exist in town. It happens everywhere, but from what I've seen, it looks like a great place to be.
Wonderful. Thank you. Crystal?
What is your ideal role you seek for the select board in supporting the town administrator to address the community's needs? Conversely, what is the ideal role for the town administrator in supporting the select board?
That's a really great question, because I usually think of it as the latter part of that question first. You know, what can the town administrator do for you, can do for the select board, and in turn, what can they do for the people of Sunderland? Because I think that's the connector in both ways. It's what can they both do to look at how we support the people of Sunderland now and into the future. So I think as long as you're focused on what that ultimate purpose is, then both ways it's going to work well. So to actually answer the question, when you think about what are things that the town that the select board can do for the town administrator. So I think it's really helpful when your select board articulates goals, when they talk about and they take that time to either through a retreat or just an annual process, look at what are the things that they're trying to accomplish that year. I think having big picture goals is helpful for a town administrator. It's ways that you can look at bringing that into every aspect of what you're doing. If the town already has a comprehensive plan or has other documents that it's done working together, I think that can serve as a really strong template to work with, and finding ways to build in check-ins each year or even more often about how are we meeting those goals together. I think that's really helpful. Obviously, strong communication both ways will help both the select board and will help the town administrator. I'm a big fan of setting up regular check-ins, so I'd want to make sure I'm checking in at least weekly with the chair, and then probably weekly as well with the other members on items that are in their portfolio. That would be important to me to make sure we have those regular times, so we can all make sure that we're staying on top of what we're doing and understand what we expect from each other. And I'd say from the very start, the other thing that would be really helpful is just getting a chance to really listen to the select board and understand what your, not just goals, but your values are and how I can work to help further those. So I think certainly strong communication, setting out goals, and then setting that regularity, I think those are all things that help each way. I know that would help me as a town administrator, and hope to help you as a select board.
Thank you. Dan?
Great. What approaches have you used or have you seen used to increase the number and diversity of volunteers serving on committees and commissions?
Great. So it's definitely a challenge. You often end up with the same folks coming to different things, and you at once want to make sure that they feel valued and keep them coming, because the lifeblood of the community. But you want to try to find more ways to engage people for sure. So one thing that we did in Newburyport this year with the new mayor, had an opportunity for some new blood last year, and then again this year, we held a boards and commissions fair. We opened up the town hall for all the boards and commissions that operate in town to bring one or two people to represent them and let people know, come on in and meet folks who are working in the different boards and commissions. That was an idea that I'd had and brought to the mayor, and he ran with it. Our administrative assistant for the mayor did a lot of the hard work to bring it all together. So it was a nice team effort. It was something that I'd heard of in some other communities. That if you can even take that a step further, there's a thing I love called the Government Academy, where you run boot camps basically to teach people about how their government works and give them some opportunities as well to learn about what the different boards and commissions do. I love that structure. I think that's great. Obviously, it helps if you're a town and city with more resources, but if you have great volunteers who understand what they do well, it's something that they could take and run with as well. So I think those are two great things that you can do. It's still a challenge to get people to come to something like that. So you also want to look for more ways to try to get more communication out to more folks. And the best communication technique that I've seen work is putting letters in either tax or water bills. And if you put some information about open vacancies or maybe information about your upcoming Government Academy or town hall open house, that can bring a lot of people in as well. People do tend to read their bills, thank goodness, and they'll often read those inserts that are in there as well. So that's a great way, because you're reaching basically everybody who pays a bill in town. So those are all some things to start with. And then, of course, there's the question of, you know, why might folks not be joining in the first place? They might not feel like these are for them. And you can try to answer what that question means to you, whether there's some kind of language or access barrier, or whether it's just all the meetings take place in the evening. If some people can't come to a meeting in the evening, would you consider having some boards that meet at a different time of day? So lots of different ways to try to meet folks.
Great, thank you. All right, our next question is, Sunderland is challenged to balance the need for development to increase its tax base with a desire to maintain its rural agricultural community. As town administrator, how do you address the need to fund continued service delivery with ongoing funding limitations?
It's a really good question. So I think the best thing that a town administrator can try to do is frame these issues for all the decision makers and all the stakeholders in town. You know, in some ways, I'd want to try to offer, you know, what guidance I can and give some ideas of what I think could work, but I really want to do the research for you and try to find what the best practices out there to help frame those decisions for the decision makers. So specifically on this issue, you know, you'd want to try to look for best practices that are out there, look at communities that have been able to find that divide, look at what can be done through some more innovative zoning that's out there. We've had a lot of luck in Newburyport. Not just luck. I think it's been a very successful program through our 40R Smart Growth District. I think that works pretty well to help manage that development while also just putting in the right places in town and still preserving what we have. We have a historic downtown core in Newburyport. If we were to overdevelop that, we'd lose that animus of the town. We'd lose what makes it a place where people want to be in the first place. You wouldn't want to do that here in Sunderland either. You want to preserve the history and preserve the rural and agricultural, you know, animus that brings people to this place and makes them proud to be here. So you'd want to make sure that you're looking at the right opportunities, that you're being proactive, you're getting into the details and really understanding implications of maybe any new zoning or any new development you might be courting, and really trying to understand how to do that thoughtfully. So for me as an administrator, again, I'd want to do the research, I'd want to present you with options that seem to be right, and then help you do that, you know, community engagement work to really listen to folks about, you know, what is it that they want to keep, what matters to them. I think there's some really good community engagement techniques you can do, especially around development, just because it's so tangible to people. They, you know, what does their neighborhood look like is one of the most tangible questions. And while a lot will say they don't want anything to change, I think if you probe a little deeper, you can find ways that people can think about things that they'd like to see happen in their community, especially when you present them with those trade-offs. You know, thinking about, would you rather see your taxes go up, or would you rather see maybe a little bit more development in another area of town? And I think once you present those trade-offs, I think it can be good, as long as you're presenting, you know, a bigger picture. You know, if people just think, well, the next thing you're going to do is develop, you know, this area that I care about, if you're articulating those values early and saying, these are the areas that we think are ripe for development, and these are the areas that we think we need to make sure we're really preserving, I think people respond to hearing those values.
Great, thank you. Crystal?
Sunderland has an excellent team of employees. Describe the town administrator's role and relationship with department heads and staff. How will you promote communication and teamwork within and across departments and from town staff, including yourself, to the community?
I need to say, this is something that I would be learning more about for sure, and I would want to talk to some successful town administrators and really understand, you know, what they've done, talk to current staff who's here and understand from them what they feel like is successful, and of course talk to you as a board. I understand that there are a few positions that would report directly to the administrator, which is great. I have a good amount of management experience, and then there's others that still reporting to the select board or to their respective chairs of different boards or commissions. But then I would be there to assist them with their work and help them carry out what they're doing, which in a lot of ways is very similar to my current role. You know, as chief of staff, my title has also been called a chief administrative officer. So I'm directly responsible for not really managing anybody at the moment, which is fantastic, but I also am the first call for basically anybody who comes in. So the fire chief, the police marshal, the building inspector. If anyone has a problem or something that they will need to eventually bring to the mayor, they usually start with me first. And we'll look for support, we'll look for a way to try to deal with an issue, whether it's a budget issue, new policy, a personnel issue. They'll usually come to me first and we can start trying to figure out how to work on it together. So I'm very comfortable with kind of this role of managing while not actually being the manager. And then I'm comfortable managing as well directly. Had direct reports before and I'm comfortable with that position as well.
Great, thank you. Dan?
Very good. Yep. Understanding the town administrator's responsibility for handling multiple priorities at once, tell us what tools you use to organize your work when there are competing priorities and sometimes competing agendas.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm a big fan of what's sometimes named the Eisenhower matrix, attributed to Dwight Eisenhower, where you look at everything on a 2x2 matrix of what's urgent and important. So that's helpful for me to key up. You know, if it's both urgent and important, you do it now. If it's important but it's not urgent, then the tool you're really using is scheduling. You're figuring out, you know, what kind of time is going to need to go into something like this, making sure that you're scheduling the time for yourself or scheduling, you know, regular meetings for the stakeholders that need to complete this together. And then when possible, if it's urgent but not important, if you can delegate, that's great. And then not urgent, not important, not important. But so I'm a big fan of the prioritization tool. It's helpful for me in kind of framing, you know, what to be doing, because, you know, time is one of the most valuable resources you have in a small town. But between time and money, that's what we have to work with. So
time is a precious resource. Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yeah. So that's the first thing I'd say. I'm a big fan of my Trello board. That's a helpful thing for me for my own personal project management. I've used that in the past, just an online platform for setting that up with other departments who maybe have like a lot of balls in the air and are having trouble kind of thinking through, you know, what are all the different tasks. Kind of that visual can be really helpful to see what that is. So I'll create shared ones sometimes and we'll work through that together. And I'm just a big fan of having deadlines and setting up timelines that make sense. So sometimes I'll use like little project management software for that, or make a Gantt chart or something if I really feel like we have a lot going on but we want to be clear on what the timelines are. Set up those rolling timelines and hold people to it. So I'm kind of comfortable in that project management set if I need to be.
Great, thank you.
Cool. All right, and our last question is much more of an open-ended question. Do you have any questions for us? Do you have anything else you'd like to tell us about yourself that you didn't have a chance to cover today?
Sure. So I guess I've been able to do, you know, some research and find out what some of the major projects you have going on are, but I'd love to hear just more about what you view as the biggest priorities and kind of what you feel like would be the most helpful for an administrator to take on rather than things that maybe the Select Board or others would be doing.
So I probably get tired of hearing me say this, but our biggest priority, our biggest challenge in town is always budgetary stuff.
Yep.
I mean, that's probably the case in most towns. But especially given the ARPA money ending, no longer having access to that, our transportation for our school, which is one of our highest ticket items in a town like ours, just went up by 76% last year, 74% or something like that. Like,
yeah.
a gross amount.
I've
yeah.
heard worse, but not much worse.
Yeah. And so, you know, for us, it's, we've had razor thin budgets for as long as I've been alive, and going into a year and years without the ARPA money to artificially fill the gap between, you know, the shortfalls in town is going to be a challenge for us. So one of our biggest challenges for this fiscal year and for probably the next couple of fiscal years is figuring out how to maintain the budget in a way that doesn't hit the pockets of the people in town more than we have to, while also not sacrificing important services in town, because, you know, there's not a lot of fat to cut out of our budget. So besides that, our big priorities in town include village center revisioning. Our village center right now is basically 116 and the side of the road off 116. We'd like that to feel more like an actual village center and give people reasons to slow down and stop and, you know, shop at the stores and whatnot in town. And Dan can go into more detail about this, but we also have a shared use path that we're working on with Amherst, connecting UMass students via bike through Sunderland all the way into Deerfield and Mount Sugarloaf, really opening up a lot of tourism, bike tourism for this part of the valley. Any other big priorities that you...
No, just, you know, again, along with the village center, just, you know, expanding on what we have here now. You know, we've got this nice little park and a river walk, and what else can we do to make that attractive to people, or recreation, something for, you know, for families and people to want to come into the center of town and hang out.
And visit the local businesses in the village center. All of this has to do with this expanding the tax base, or bringing in, you know, bringing in visitors to the community to help generate revenues for the town. So it is all tying into exactly what Nathaniel explained, the financial challenges we have. So
where are the opportunities there to kind of build on that? And village center is a great idea, just be able to bring out some of the things that you love about the community and bring more people to it. So something I feel somewhat familiar with, the work in mass development. So it's great.
Dan, did you have anything you wanted to add that I missed?
No, I think it's good. I mean, really just to get people to kind of driving through and stop and look around and shop and eat and everything. Use the river, use the mountain. We've got a great resource there. And we just need more people to know it.
Do you imagine the town administrator having a role in kind of that economic development work and trying to help with those issues? Yeah, good. Yeah.
I think the former town administrator, Dan, you'd know more about this, but I think the former town administrator was involved or participating with the Village Center Committee in through the entire visioning process and was helping support them. You know, understanding, of course, the town administrator has the day-to-day, you know, chief administrator of officer role, and they need to tackle that. So, which I would imagine could cause a little bit of strain on the administrator's time. But yeah, the administrator... Jeff was very involved in that.
Yeah, certainly was.
Yeah.
And what was the reaction to the 2021 Rapid Recovery Plan on the Village Center? I'm just curious what folks, you know, thought about that and how helpful that was as a starting point.
I don't know a lot about that effort, but I know that became the Village Center whole visioning exercise that we're wrapping up now. That was kind of the place where it all started, and now we're going through the vision. Village Center Committee to kind of go through and bring it to the next level.
It's kind of the best. The
main road is all controlled by MassDOT,
right?
So it's that kind of relationship too. We have to think about.
Yeah, the Stantec is the company that advises us on that, and the Stantec guy came out here said, I'm not going to represent his words exactly, but something along the lines of, I've never seen a more egregious use of a town by the state than Sunderland having 116 plowed through us, because 116 didn't exist, I don't know, what was it, 60, 70 years ago or something like that. There used to be a nice
look
little...
Look at me like I was alive. You remember that, right?
You've been town longer than I do. You know things I don't know. Come on.
But the
state decided that they needed a big old road from Amherst up to 91, and so they... basically just took our nice little tiny road and threw a giant highway through the middle of it with no buy-in from the town, really, you know. And we've been sitting there for the last, you know, half a century trying to figure out, how do we get back the feel that we lost? How do we slow traffic down and make it less than just a thoroughway through our town? Especially because it's not just that it was like off the side somewhere. Like, that's our main drag. That's where our church is and our convenience stores and whatnot. And so the Village Center visioning process is not just about how do we make it more functional, but how do we recapture some of the feel that we had in the past, and how do we, you know, obviously we don't have a choice about whether or not 116 runs through our town. We can't go to the state and say, get it out of here. That's never going to happen. But how can we work with the state to try to take back some of the control we have over part of our town, and make it feel, again, less like a town that happens to be around 116, as opposed to this is one of our main roads going through town.
Yeah, and to the Village Center Committee's credit, I'm sorry, I keep chiming in. To the Village Center Committee's credit, they have heavily engaged MassDOT. MassDOT is very involved in their meetings, and they're going to be having a community outreach meeting soon. Yeah, so they are getting a lot of feedback from MassDOT. So this can potentially be a very successful effort.
Yep.
That's very exciting. Cool. On the financial side too, what's the town's kind of grant situation looking like? Is the number of things to be able to
so
do with grants?
We have a handful of grants. Most of our grants are targeted grants for a specific project.
Yeah.
you know, we're applying for a grant for this particular thing, for this particular thing. We do have a couple of recurring grants, things like we have a grant that the police chief applied to last 2 years ago that provides for a mental health worker to go with a police officer to mental health crisis situations, that kind of thing. That being said, there is definitely, the sky's the limit for improvement in terms of how many grants we apply for and the scope that we look to apply to. Our biggest limitation is your time. You know, well, there's one town administrator, we don't have a full-time grant writer. You know,
there's the balance with grants, right?
Absolutely.
You know, like we you get grant money to build something, that's wonderful, but we have to keep in mind maintaining it. I think that's someplace that not every time, not all the time, but that kind of falls short sometimes for us is, you know, we can find the money and we can get the grant to build something, but then when, again, it goes right back to budgeting, right? We get into one of these tight areas and now, you know, we're going to take what used to be $5,000 to maintain this and we don't have the money this year, so, you know, we won't maintain it this year. We'll do it next year. And that's...
And there's an additional level of complexity, which is that we're in Western Mass and Boston is in Eastern Mass.
Yeah.
And so we'll get a grant for something and they'll require that we use their architects from Boston for something. And then they require that we use this and this and this. And in the end, like, if we had done it ourselves, it would be a $1 million project. We got $1 million from the government and it cost $2 million to do it. So at that point, it's like there's times where we didn't actually save the town any money. We just took control and gave it to the state, and it ended up costing us that much more because of that. And so
we also have the opportunity to leverage the resources of some two really powerful regional agencies, the Housing Authority and Housing and Redevelopment Authority, and the FERCOG.
Mm-hmm.
And RDI was very instrumental in moving the Sanderson Place over 55 housing development forward.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a good point.
Yeah, the FERCOG is definitely one of the things that we have for
a benefit.
Yeah, and that's the Franklin Regional County of Governors and governments. And so that is one of the things that definitely helps to sort of shore up small towns' lack of administrators, is we get some services through them and some collective bargaining and that kind of stuff through them. So that's very helpful. And the town administrator would definitely be very closely working with the FERCOG and with other agencies in the area.
Sunderland is a green community. Right. Sunderland has a municipal vulnerability preparedness plan, which I believe needs to be updated a little bit to kind of reprioritize some of the hazard vulnerabilities on it in order to get funding. I'm trying to, excuse me?
Complete streets too?
Yeah, we've done complete streets. Right. Yeah.
Yep.
That's kind of the roster of them.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now we've got some unique, like our emergency medical services are unique here. We're regionalized.
Yeah, that's great.
We have South County EMS. Our senior center is regionalized. Our middle school through high school.
I do have to say that's another reason why I'd be very excited about working here. I'm a big regionalization fan. And I know it's difficult, but I think the benefits are worth it. It's something that I've tried to push for, you know, even the larger communities.
Yeah.
I think it can work really well.
Yeah. I can tell you, I can guarantee you that at one point I thought South County EMS was never going to work. And it's one of the it's an amazing service now.
It's becoming a model that other regions are looking at to maintain good regional services.
Because you can't do volunteer ambulance anymore. It's just impossible.
The contracted model isn't always going to work. The staffing issues we've had in the last couple of years have made that not reliable either.
Ask Hadley. Tough. Hadley.
I think that. That's really one of the silver linings of all this is that we have a very good group of towns in this area that work very closely together, not just the South County, but Franklin County in general, and not just Franklin County, but, you know, Northampton and Amherst, and, you know, there's good communication between town administrators. Something that we want to foster is that relationship. And because we have that good relationship, a lot of things run smoothly. The frontier funding, you know, is not very contentious, that kind of thing. And that's definitely, I think, a perk for the town, but also a perk for the town administrator is having those pre-existing relationships already set up and a real cooperative feel amongst the towns in this area.
Now, that networking is so important just for facing those challenges that, you know, only those who are in them can really understand. I started a chief of staff network in Massachusetts in the last year to help, you know, with the networking and you know, monthly discussion group about different issues going on in cities in Massachusetts. So that's been a really helpful thing for me and for the network. So it's a thing that I like a lot.
I don't know if you've heard of STAM, Small Town Administrators of Massachusetts.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's
well,
got a reputation.
It does. Yeah. That's been a very strong organization and just a valuable network for small town administrators.
Hey.
Yeah.
Very nice.
And I was involved in the naming of the organization.
Great.
Before I ask him if he has any more questions, Dan, do you have anything you want to chime in on?
No, I'm good.
All right. So I think we have time for one more question from you if you have anything else for us.
No, I can just say, is there anything else that you feel like I didn't get to touch on in my answers here? I drove a long way and be very happy to answer more questions for a little while. Just before
it was quite a long drive for you, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yep.
To address that, because I think it is helpful. So my wife and I have a 10-month-old daughter. Happy to show pictures after the meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah, excellent. And we're really looking for the place to call home right now. She's got ties to Western Mass, and this feels like it would really be a special place to live out here in the Pioneer Valley. So we're committed to making the move. We're excited about it. So I think this would be this feels like the right time, right place to be here.
Well, we totally agree with you that this is one of the most beautiful, special places in the world. Amazing schools out here, amazing people, great place to raise kids. One of the reasons I raised my kids here as well. But great, thank you so much for coming in. Really appreciate it. Look forward to talking to you again soon.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry, I didn't mention the process. The select board's process. Let me just... Very quickly. So that's obviously the board has, the town has a vacancy in the town administrator position. So the board is doing its due diligence to try to move as expeditiously as possible and making a decision on offering a conditional employment to one of the finalists. And the board will begin discussions tonight. And we'd expect a decision in the very near future. All finalists will be notified of the status of the board's decision as soon as the board makes that decision.
That's fantastic.
Okay.
Well, it's great to meet you all.
You
great
too.
To meet you as well.
Yeah, good to see you on the Zoom.
Thank you.
Great. Nice seeing you, Andrew.
Nice
take care.
Nice
to meet you too in person.
All right, so we are down to the discussing part.
I'm very pleased with tonight's discussion.
Oh yeah, no, they all made it a very hard decision, so that is definitely a thing.
I mean, do we want to each like take and put them in order and see if we agree before we even, and then we'll kind of figure out how much discussion we even need to have?
Wonderful idea.
I am fine with that. So yeah, if everyone would... You want to rank all four or just do number one, number two choice for...
I would say all four and then, you know, we could probably go from there and...
Okay.
If we agree on the top two, then all we have to do is discuss the top two, right?
Yep. Okay.
Do any of the board members have a strong... a strong sense of one of the candidates that you'd like to start with?
I'll go. My top choice would be Nick. That was going to be my top choice. I think he was very professional. I think he has good experience with a similarly sized town with similar, you know, challenges to our town. And I felt like his answers were, you know, appropriate to what I was looking for and whatnot. So
I did number one is Andrew. Who'd you do number one as?
Yeah, gosh, that's tough. I'm trying to think of what we're looking for. I want to hopefully talk about it, I guess, so I'm just going to pick one.
Well, no, but again, we already don't agree, so it's going to be a discussion.
Yeah. Okay. So, to be fair, Andrew's my number two. And so if you guys both have Andrew as number one and I got Andrew as number two, I think that that's a pretty resounding first choice, I would say. I'm perfectly happy having him as our first choice. Honestly, him and Nick were very close neck to neck for me in terms of their history, what they can bring to the town. Largely for me, what it really came down to is I felt like Nick had slightly more experience with our level of government.
You've done it before, yes.
And I think that while Andrew definitely can certainly come up to speed and whatnot, there is a certain amount of he's used to a higher level of support at his current positions in terms of other employees, in terms of larger budgets, in terms of larger everything.
Yep.
And just if we were talking about a more seasoned select board moving into hiring somebody who doesn't have experience in this particular type of town and things, I would be more comfortable. My first priority here was who can we get in that day one is going to be able to pick up, run with things, and get us to where we need to go with the least amount of uptick while also maintaining the most amount of long-term potential.
Yeah, I agree.
So that for me, that's why Nick just edged out Andrew a little bit. That being said, Andrew definitely has a whole lot going for her in terms of skills and knowledge and pedigree and whatnot that any town would be thrilled to have.
Yeah.
Not saying that. He's definitely an amazing candidate.
I had Rebecca as my number two.
So Rebecca's a great choice also. Just like Nick, she also has that small town experience. Shutesbury is a little further from Sunderland in terms of budget and makeup and whatnot than Nick's community is, which is why I rank her slightly below Nick in that respect. But I also think that she brings a lot of realistic expectations and understandings that I think the other three candidates kind of had a little bit maybe more pie in the sky kind of ideas about things. She was much more like, no, I know there's challenges. I know there's stuff. Let's talk about what we can do about those kind of things. So she was great also. Again, for me, Nick was number one, but I'd be perfectly happy to go with Andrew if Dan and Crystal, you feel that that's the direction we should go in.
Well, I do say that, you know, that Rebecca and Nick are the ones that have experience as town administrators.
Yes.
So, and I guess, you know, again, we're a volunteer board, so there is something to be said for somebody who's done it.
Yeah.
And knows it, walking in the door, there's not really a big learning curve.
Yeah.
I mean, but I got the sense that Andrew knew enough to be able to come and probably take care of it. But there's definitely something to be said for the experience that the other two bring, especially Rebecca, who's been doing it for a long time. And it certainly could walk in tomorrow and once she gets to know everybody, she'd be running away. And they're probably the same for Nick.
I have to say, she did definitely seem the most comfortable of the four of them in terms of, like, not that being nervous in an interview is a problem. Everybody gets nervous in an interview. You know, like I'm the first person to be sitting there sweating, tapping the table. But just that she seemed very much like if we hired her tomorrow and she walked into the position, she'd be starting tomorrow. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that very little need for getting her up to speed. Although the same thing can be said for Nick, that again, the two of them with that experience, you know, it gives them a big boon in terms of walking in day one. Now, I know we don't necessarily want to just entirely prioritize our own comfort and our own expeditious nature. You know, we also want to be thinking about, you know, if they're perfect day one, but they're the same person after 2 years, is that what the town needs in 2 years? You know, somebody who has more potential long term and needs more time to get up to speed may not be what we need necessarily today in October, November, but maybe exactly what we need next year and the year after that and whatnot.
It's a tough choice. Definitely a variety.
Yeah.
Yes.
No, they didn't make it easy. I was secretly hoping that there was one candidate that was just going to be so obvious that we'd all be like, so it's this person, right? Yeah, okay, cool, let's move on. But no, I mean, really, the candidates all made it very good arguments and very good, you know, they presented themselves very well. It makes it hard for us to make a decision there. Dan, who was your number two?
Well, I probably went with Rebecca, just because So you have experience, you can walk right in.
So we do. So what we have right now is Andrew is your guys' first and my second. Rebecca is second and my third. So it sounds like those two are probably the top two that we're looking at. It sounds like if the two of you were to choose between Rebecca and Nick, you probably go with Rebecca. That kind of what it sounds like to me, just based on your rankings. Yeah. You know, I know who your one and two are, so that means that he's got to be in your three and fours. That being said, you know, I'm fine with it coming down to Rebecca and Andrew in terms of our top two. The question becomes, which do we want to have be our one, and which do we want to have be our that falls through, you know?
I honestly think, given where we are in the whole town area demographic looking for town administrators, I think we should maybe pick. I know this only has two, but I think we should also decide on a third.
Okay. And you can certainly.
Yeah. So yeah, I would say Nick would be our third also. No offense to Steven, but he's still a little bit more rough than I think a board of our current experience needs. Yeah. We need someone with a little bit more experience. You know, Steve, if you're watching this, you did a great job. I think you were a wonderful candidate. And in a couple of years, a little more experience under your belt, you're going to do a great job, great things in sort of a town somewhere. So that being said, I think we're all in agreement that our number three choice would then be Nick.
Yes, definitely.
Okay. So Nick is number three. And that will be if we end up needing to offer to a third candidate because of the competition that we have.
Or somebody just withdraws because it's not.
It happens. So the question again becomes Andrew or Rebecca for number one and number two. It sounds based on the initial impressions that Andrew had a little bit of an edge. But back to the whole Rebecca and Nicholas having more experience and being able to step in day one. Yeah. I don't know, that's a hard one.
So I could easily switch. I could easily put Rebecca as my. It's tough because I think for me at least, Rebecca and Andrew very much have very different skill sets, but their skill sets and stuff are relatively equal.
Mm-hmm. It's very much they're neck and neck, but not neck and neck with the same things. You know what I mean? They're neck and neck with different things where it's like, well, can I pick some of your skill set and some of your skill set and make one administrator? But yeah, I think that the question that the three of us really need to decide is what is the experience or the potential the bigger issue? And that's not to say that Andrew has more potential than any of the candidates does, just that he's somebody who needs some time to get up to speed and does have...
What's he need time to get up to speed on?
He doesn't know any of the other town administrators in Western Mass. He doesn't know a lot of the politics, stuff like that. And not to say that that will take him a huge amount of time or anything like that. But also, he hasn't been a town administrator itself. So it's a new position for him.
And he actually said, his answer to question number five, he actually said he was lacking there.
Yeah.
It would be, it's a transition for anyone going from... another sector or a larger community to small town administration. I was one of those. Yeah, yeah. I was in Amherst for years before I came here to Sunderland. It does. It's a transition. Anyway, this is your decision. Yeah. I do think he's amply capable of learning the job and taking it.
The only risk I have with Andrew is just looking at his resume. It's 2 years here, 2 years there, 2 years there, and do 2 years of someone really good is good what we want. That maybe we get, but just something that.
No, and that's a concern that I have also in terms of, it would not be unfair to say that his resume makes him overqualified for the position. Is he going to be happy in this position for the next 10 years? Or is he going to find himself 2 years from now being in a position where, my kid's a little older, I'm less worried about you know, being there all the time for a you know, a young child, and is he going to want to move into Greenfield or Northampton or Amherst or something like that? I'm not saying there's any kind of foregone conclusion there, but that is definitely a concern in terms of whether he's sizing his job correctly for our town or not for his long term, and whether or not that means that we're going to have another town administrator search in 2 years.
Well, yeah. Unfortunately, there are never any guarantees.
There are never any guarantees. Oh, and there are never any of our people.
A lot of his references, and on all of their references, I probed that question.
Mm-hmm.
Because Nick was very clear in his screening interview that he wants to be a town manager. That's his goal. And Andrew is on a stepping stone, and he made it really clear, and his references made it really clear, that he wants to be a small town administrator.
Oh, okay.
And I struggled with that.
Mm-hmm.
But that came through clearly, repeatedly, that he doesn't have the visions and he wants to be a regional, he wants to be a collaborator in regional efforts.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he wants to be.
I absolutely see him as being, I absolutely see him as being capable of heading up regional initiatives, you know, with our neighboring communities. And I see him able to do that. I see him as
And I mean, I think, unfortunately, I think regional is, you know, and again, I'll be the first one to admit, I never thought South County EMS would work. And I have never been more impressed by an ambulance service. So I do believe regionalization is, for our area, unfortunately, it's the coming future. I believe we're going to have more regionalized services going forward. So, you know, I think that's another
The other thing I'll say about Nick and Andrew is they've worked in multiple communities, so they bring a breadth of different ideas.
Mm-hmm.
That's true.
No, and there is definitely something to be said also for the other two candidates we're talking about are moving from a smaller community into a larger community. Having him going from a larger community into a smaller community means he brings ideas and experience and possibly trainings and whatnot that smaller towns don't have the funds and time to send their town administrators on. So he definitely does bring a different perspective than we're used to. I'm just trying to figure out whether that's the perspective we want.
And Becky brings... She gets it innately.
Yep.
She
does.
So long.
Yes.
Yeah. And again, that's one of the things with Becky for me is that she's been in the game in Western Mass in Franklin County for 30 years. Not that Andrew can't, you know, make those relationships real fast, but you've been in Sunderland so long that when you came into this position, you knew Crystal's mom. You know what I mean?
Right. That
feel and that kind of thing is an intangible benefit that we in a small town like this, it really matters. If it's Boston, who cares whether the chief of staff of Boston, you know, is a nice person? You're never going to talk to them anyways. In Sunderland, this is the first person that they're going to talk to every single time. And, you know, again, that relationship building, that regional knowledge is important to us.
I just want to note, and hopefully this doesn't complicate your discussion. It sounds like you're all pretty much following the same track. But I just want to say, Shutesbury has dealt with major PFAS issues, which Sunderland is just beginning to see now. They have 72 properties that have been affected by PFAS. That is massive for a tiny town. So, you know, when we talk about innate, it's those types of things, you know, that hands-on stuff.
And that's really sort of where I'm going is Rebecca and Nick, for that matter, bring in our status quo, bring in another person who replaces the last person who does the job the last person does and does it the way that we've been used to doing it. And the question is that what we're looking for, or are we looking for somebody to come in with fancier ideas from a fancier part of the state to change things. there's definitely pluses and minuses to that. You know, they bring in knowledge that we don't have, but they also bring in preconceived notions and ways of doing things that may not jive with the small town vibe that we have here. And do we find ourselves having to push back to the new town administrator on wanting to change Sunderland into a town that's more like towns that they're used to? I'm not saying necessarily is going to happen, but just, you know, we know what we get when we go with somebody like Rebecca or Nicholas in terms of, you know, we know that they can handle a Western Mass town.
Yeah.
You know. So it kind of sounds to me like Becca and Andrew are sort of neck to neck, and it's a real question of which direction do we want to go in. Do we want to do a quick little informal go around and say how we're feeling 1-2 right now and see if we're all in agreement there?
Yeah, I can do that.
All right. I would say right now I am leaning towards Rebecca number one, Andrew number two.
I am leaning towards Rebecca number one, Andrew number two. Sam!
Yeah, I'll concur.
Okay.
I struggle to leave Nicholas on the table, that's all. Yeah.
So Nicholas is going to be our number three. And, you know, we, as has been said a number of times tonight, this is a very competitive season for town administrators. There are more towns than I can even remember right now in this area who are looking for them. So our decision on 1-2-3 may be far less important than we want it to be. That decision may end up being out of our hands at the end of the day. But it sounds like we have a 1-2-3, Rebecca, Andrew, Nick. Does that sound...
No, you got to say it. If
you all have to be comfortable with it.
Yeah. Because if you do not think Rebecca is the right number one choice, you have to say it, and we can keep discussing this.
Well, I think it's smooth sailing. I mean, it's definitely the easy. It's easier. I mean, to keep things rolling because she can come right in. I definitely agree with that.
What is it about now? You were concerned about Nick, as.
No, it's the same thing. I mean, I'm just looking at the qualifications and the education that they had. I know Rebecca brings a lot of experience, so I see her as a good choice because she knows the area. She knows, and I expect she's probably going to stay right here and be happy. So I'm fine with that choice.
Now, there's no relocation expenses provided, no nothing like that.
That would all be negotiated in the contract if there was an ask.
Yeah.
You've got two candidates who are fairly local here that you've been discussing. The other, I can't speak to that. It would be part of contract negotiations.
Yeah.
But it sounds like that candidate is already interested in moving this way anyways. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's a lot harder to convince somebody who wants to stay in Eastern Mass to come out here.
Oh, yeah, that's
if he
tough.
Wants to come out here already, that's going to make it easier.
But we also never asked Nick.
That's true.
He lives in Pittsfield. And it's not
that's
like
true.
Easy commute.
Yeah, that is an over an hour. Yeah. That's true. Which also is another benefit of Rebecca is that she lives, you know, 17 minutes that way or something like that, right in the center of Shrewsbury. So she's about as local as you're going to get. All right. So it sounds like, unless there's any more discussion that needs to be done, that we have come up with our 1-2-3 for Rebecca, Andrew, and then Nick. I would entertain a motion to. Do you want a motion for this or?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
It's the written one here on the bottom.
The motion, the motion is on the bottom of the sheet, and I would ask that the motion also authorize the chair or another member, if the chair is unable to do this, to negotiate the contract terms and bring back recommendations to the board. This will alleviate the need for the board to go into executive for all contract negotiations.
Gotcha. So. This plus authorizing you to do the contract negotiations? Sorry, you want us to authorize you to be able to do the contract?
No, I said the chair or another member.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, that's fine.
Gotcha, okay, sorry.
Don't mind sitting in.
No, I was just...
All right, so I'll do the motion then.
Yeah, please.
I move that the board make a conditional offer of employment to Rebecca Torres, subject to satisfactory reference, background, inquiry checks, and successful negotiation of terms of employment. I would also move that the board make a contingent offer to second choice, or to reserve the right for second choice, I guess?
No. Make a contingent offer of employment to Andrew Levine.
If negotiations with Rebecca Torres are unsuccessful. Subject satisfactory reference checks, backgrounds, inquiry checks, and successful negotiation of terms of employment.
And Crystal, in both cases, authorize the chair to...
All right. I authorize the chair to enter into negotiations with either...
Well, yep.
With either Rebecca Torres as the first choice or Andrew Levine as the second choice.
And bring back...
What?
Why don't we do a third as well? Okay. You discussed
all
that.
Right, yeah.
I didn't put it here, but I think
wise. I move that the board makes a contingent offer of employment to third choice, Nick Cacamo, if negotiations with Rebecca Torres and or Adam Levine are unsuccessful. Subject status, Andrew, what did I say?
Adam, he's a rock star.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, that's right.
Adam, Andrew Levine are unsuccessful. Subject satisfactory reference check, background, inquiry checks, and successful negotiation of terms of employment.
And in all cases, the chair...
In all cases, the chair will...
Is
authorized to negotiate terms of employment.
All right, we have a motion made. Do we have a second?
Second.
All right, we have a motion made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, Murphy.
All right, 3-0. Thank you very much, everybody.
Would the board like me to contact Rebecca, or would you like to designate the chair to contact Rebecca?
I'm perfectly happy to have you go ahead
and
let her know.
Okay.
You know, obviously send her our best and thank her for coming in and you know, look
so
forward to working
with her. Before we go too far down that, or not too far, doesn't matter. What it would be typical if she asks for time to think about it?
Limited. It's got to be limited in
right.
this
case.
Right.
So that's why I'm
say.
Saying I think we need to come up with.
Or not even. I mean, give her through the weekend. Through the weekend.
Okay. So if you contact her tomorrow, she'll have till.
Till Monday.
Monday.
Till.
Close of business.
Yeah. End of day Monday.
Yeah.
Okay.
And if she hasn't come back to us or she says no at that point, then we move to number two. And
right. And that's why I just wanted to. Do we need a motion on that to. Or no?
No, that's okay. I understand.
Yep.
All right.
Wonderful.
And then again, with the whoever, you know, if it goes to number two or number three, it'll be, you know, the same type of.
Okay.
All right. So I'm going to have us fly through the end of the meeting so we can get out of here. So we're going to do a very quick select board updates. I have nothing. Crystal?
I have nothing.
Dan?
Senior Center is, I know they're moving ahead. I should have a date. Mark, if you could help me with getting out the date on the next thing.
Okay.
They're narrowing down the selection to two of the three locations for the Senior Center study. There's one in Whitley, there's the Congregational Church in Deerfield, and there's basically the Sunderland property down in Plum Tree. So they're narrowing it down to two. For some reason, they couldn't bring forward the three. And that's upcoming, but I apologize. I don't have the exact date, but that is coming. People are interested in it, and they really feel strongly. They should definitely let Margaret let everybody know.
So it's just the place in Whately and just the property in Sunderland.
Yeah. Well, they studied all three. And now they're basically trying to narrow it down to two to kind of, I think they're to bring it to the next level of study. So they're trying to knock out one because they say they don't have enough money to look at all three.
So
it's an important decision.
Oh no, it's a very important decision, but so would the senior center purchase the Plum Tree Road property themselves?
At the same time, they're looking at it becoming a consortium, which would allow to allow the consortium itself to basically do a purchase and finance a building rather than through one of the towns.
Yeah.
So we're trying to figure it all out. But as far as the study goes, they're trying to narrow it down to two. So it's an important decision coming up soon. And apologies. I will make sure I get the date to Marty to let everyone know when that next meeting is coming up.
Okay. We could put it on news on the website as well. I'm just wondering about the consortium. I don't have that information, but I mean, clearly someone's got to pay for the purchase if the
course,
right?
Of course. You know, we come from the towns, you know,
Yeah.
No, as long as the thought wasn't that Sunderland was still going to be interested in purchasing that property, because.
That's true.
I don't think. You know, at one point it was a consideration. I don't believe.
I think that my recollection is the board all agreed that we don't want to be landlords. So, yeah.
Don't know what?
We don't want to be landlords. We don't want to be in the business of having to have tenants and deal with all that, because that's a whole thing. But anyways, thank you for that update, Dan. Anything else before we move on? Thank you.
We'll be inviting the VHB to come do a kickoff in one of the next few meetings. I'll reach out to you, Nate. We'll get that scheduled.
Yes, and the Village Center Committee is going to be having a forum on October 10th.
That's right. On the 10th, we have a meeting Thursday, and then on the 10th, we have a big public forum at the library. So
wonderful! Thank you very much, Dan. All right, Margaret. Any town administrator updates that you haven't covered?
I mentioned earlier that free cash has been certified. It's about $644,000. I had hoped that it would be a few hundred thousand more than that, but it's $644,000, a little plus. We also got word this week that the resident whose residential well has been affected by PFAS, has acknowledged receipt of the letters from our engineer and the town, and has agreed to move forward with the process. So we now start looking into the POET system.
Great. That's wonderful news. I'm glad that we made contact with them.
Yep.
All right. Anything else from you, Margaret?
That's it for today.
Wonderful. We have executive session on here, but we don't need to meet because we just did it in public session, so no need for executive session. The last thing before we adjourn is our next regular meeting will be Tuesday, October 15th, 2024, and that'll be our normal 6:30 time. At this time, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
I motion we adjourn.
Second.
We have a motion made and seconded to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, Dan Murphy.
Aye. 3-0, Margaret. Time is 9:17.